More Stories podcast. My friends, use the Amazon banner at jmore.com. I would give you an Amazon read, but you know what? Just do it. Use the Amazon banner. It's a, you know what it is? It's a rectangle that says Amazon, and then just email me at jmore.com what you bought, and I'll read it on this program right here, and it'll be your special episode. John Ziegler's here, and I don't want to waste any time getting into what we're talking about. You, my friend, are... Well, first of all, there's the John and Leah radio show, and that's on johnandleahradio.com. You can look that up, L-E-A-H, Leah. There's all different ways to spell Leah.
Yes.
Like, there's a Springsteen song, Leah, Princess Leah.
Or you can just go to Free Speech Broadcasting.
FreeSpeechBroadcasting.com.
And that'll do it.
John Zygmunt Freud on Twitter. I was doing a radio show, my radio show, and... I had a whole monologue about Penn State because new things came up. It's 1976 instead of 1987 or 2000. And again, this this horrible story that we all know of. And you're here because you are this voice that at first there's a pushback, an enormous pushback.
Mm-hmm.
And there's very few people out there. I heard you on Paul Feinbaum today. There's few people that when you just slow it down, get the hysteria down, relax, listen, turn everything down, turn up the quiet. The more I read and the more I watch videos that you've done, there's an alarming McMartin preschool, West Memphis 3. This is larger. This, you, my friend, very well could be the person that could get Jerry Sandusky out of jail. For the actual right reason. So you're sort of alone on this. So to the listener listening, you need to know, because your knee-jerk response is, I'm not going to listen to this shit. No, you are going to listen to this. That's why you subscribe to this podcast. John would not be in my home if this didn't alarm me. All right. Penn State. This is what everybody knows.
Right.
Kids were molested by Jerry Sandusky. Joe Paterno knew about it. He didn't do enough. He did the bare minimum legally, went to his immediate superior, allowed Jerry Sandusky back on campus, knowing he was a monster and a child molester. Everybody found out in the media. ESPN had vigils outside. They had reporting outside of Paterno's home. Poor Joe, his last words, almost his last words, I should have done more, I could have done more. Sandusky now is in jail. He's going to die in jail.
Mm-hmm.
And Joe Paterno, no longer the head coach of Penn State, like many, died of no purpose.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that's what we all know.
That's a pretty good synopsis of the media narrative. Yes.
That's the succinctest, most truncated form that everybody knows. We know this is fact.
Right, because the media told you.
Now, you got to be aware, because you're intelligent and you're a nationally syndicated talk show. You're in Talkers 100. You're up there. You're like a guy. You're a player. Whenever you say the media, it's like 9/11-y. It's truthers.
Right,
it's
right.
Where's the birth certificate, all this
right,
stuff.
Right, right.
But the media plays an enormous part in this. So you told me over the phone... You interviewed Jerry Sandusky...
Twice in prison for hours.
And how long was that first interview?
The first interview was 3 hours in person and a half hour on the phone. You'll love this element of the story. To my knowledge, his interview in prison is the only interview in the history of Pennsylvania state prisons to be recorded. Because it's against the rules of the prison. They give no permission to do so. I didn't even bother to ask because Oprah had been turned down previously on other interview requests. I mean, this is a hard, fast rule. So what I did was, because I knew no one was going to believe anything I said. And let me make it clear. At this point, I presume Jerry Sandusky was guilty like the rest of the world. But you'll love how I got the interview recorded. I was allowed to bring in a pad of paper and a pen. So I brought in a James Bond recording pen into the Pennsylvania State Prison in maximum security prison in Pennsylvania, and I recorded the whole thing.
I'm just, you know what? Doing a podcast and things that go wrong on a podcast, I'm like, wait, the pen had 3 hours of storage? Maybe a guy wrongly convicted of child molestation, like 10 counts. I'm like, wait, how, three
actually,
hours
you'll,
of storage?
You'll wait a minute. You'll love the pen story. So because I was so paranoid about getting caught, I presumed that when I went through security, that they might try to take the pen apart. So what I did, which was incredibly stupid, was that the only way you could tell it was a recording pen is if you pulled the top of it out. So I super glued the top of the pen together so that it would be impossible, if the security at the maximum security prison where Jerry Sandusky is examined it, which was brilliant in the short run, except incredibly stupid in the long run. Because as soon as I get out, I had been told that if I used this super glue dissolver, that the thing would immediately open. The dissolver didn't work. So now the pen was locked, and all the three-hour interview was locked inside the pen.
You're just staring at a pen.
I've got a pen with 3 hours of Jerry Sandusky in prison, and I can't get to it.
Don't look. Maybe you're new. If you want to smuggle things into prison, I brought in birthday cake, sausages. It just goes in the butt. Don't you watch Lockup? You find a cavity and get going. I mean, all this
I was
crazy
willing to world. Do just about anything. So anyway, the long story short was it took me quite a long time, a lot of money. We had to destroy the pen in order to salvage the audio. So that's a very long answer to your first question. Well, we're on pace for about a four-hour interview point.
My run-up was very long anyway. So you interviewed – I want to go step by step because I think this needs to be done linearly for people to really grasp what's happening. So you interviewed Jerry Sandusky.
Presuming he's guilty. That's important because the reason I got into this, Jay, because – as a documentary filmmaker, I specialize in subjects where I think the media blew it. And it was my presumption that they blew it on the Joe Paterno angle, because it didn't make any sense, the story that was being told about Joe Paterno. But I presumed...
Which part? You thought...
There's no way that Joe Paterno knew, because it was completely incompatible, one, with what we knew of him, as well as what we knew of the facts of the case. By the way, almost everything we thought we knew at the time of Paterno's firing turned out to be false. All of it.
Yeah, but don't, if you jump ahead, if I know, I'm going to go linearly, we've got to go linearly.
I understand, together. But I'm just trying to explain. Yeah. As a little bit of background, I used to be a TV sportscaster. That's how I began my career. I have coached high school football. I have covered high school, college, and pro football. I know a lot about football and coaching and the culture. And there was nothing about that original Mike McQueary story that made a lick of sense. And so I'm interviewing Sandusky, trying to get to the bottom of what really happened here with regard to Paterno. And I was pretty stunned by the experience because I learned a lot of stuff
now
that we never knew before.
You went in thinking that Jerry Sandusky was a child molester, and there's just no way Joe Paterno, a man of such character, could possibly have covered up for Jerry Sandusky.
Exactly.
Now, I'm going as basic as possible.
Sure. That's
because
good.
I
understand.
Once it gets wider and wider and wider, it's like a Michael Douglas movie of like, you don't even know the half of it.
I understand.
So, okay. The first accusation against Jerry Sandusky, victim number one, Aaron Fisher.
That's correct. Yes. Okay. His name.
His mom and him have since published a book.
Yes.
There's Porsches in the driveway. literally.
Yes, which I have photographed.
That's right, yeah. And then you have had death threats from Mr. Fisher?
I interpret them as death threats, yeah. I mean, when he threatens to run you over.
You went to Georgetown.
I went to Georgetown. I have no connection to Penn State at all.
No. You went to Georgetown University. You graduated. It's either a death threat or it's not.
I didn't really believe it, but let me put it this way. The police were alerted that there was a threat. Yes.
So victim one.
Yes, Aaron Fisher.
Okay. He accuses Jerry Sandusky of sexually molesting him. When?
Well, that's an interesting question because you have seen, or at least you're aware of.
If the first one's interesting, then...
Right.
This might be 4 hours.
Right. Well, okay. let me give you. I'm trying to give you the short version.
Fastball.
All right. In late 2008, Aaron Fisher who has been, I would say, being mentored by Jerry Sandusky for a couple of years at this time. He's almost 15 years old. I have a witness, the next door neighbor of the Fisher household, and when I mean next door neighbor, I'm talking. The houses are attached to each other. It's welfare housing. It's welfare housing.
So late 2008.
Late 2008.
And if I interrupt you, it's only because I'm mindful of someone listening and I want to go.
Sure.
Like A.
Please do.
B, C.
Absolutely.
D. So the first accusation. See, we think in the national mind that this has been going on since, you know, 90, like we all knew, like the accusations right. kept going right. and it was generating for a decade. But 2008 to me, just right now, seems, wait a minute, that's like just, that's 8 years ago. That's not.
The first time that anybody ever made a claim that Jerry Sandusky sexually molested them was Aaron Fisher in late 2008.
Okay.
And the story of how that really happened is quite interesting and I think very important.
All right.
Because I have this interview at framingpaterno.com, which is my website. By the way, the framing is figurative. It's not literal. I am not a conspiracy person.
I saw
person.
This. Is this the one you sent me, the half hour?
Yeah.
Brilliant.
Okay. Well, thank
like,
you. I
appreciate brilliant,
it.
And you go in that half hour, whoa, wait a minute. And I got to tell you something. Turning the bus around and going in the other direction from child molestation towards it
right.
to spring... It's uncomfortable. This is an uncomfortable thing for a national media for you to crack the code. But you don't need the national media. It's conversations like this, the one you have with Feinbaum. Your facts are your facts. Nothing you've presented to me or that I've read is subjective. These are facts.
Right.
So we are going to deal with truths.
Right.
And nothing. So let's try to edit as we go. That nothing, and that would mean, or that assumption could lead to, right. let's go just with the facts. Because if, this is what I told Corey before you came in, if 10% of what you're saying is true,
well, it
there's
all
an innocent man in jail.
Well, thank you. I appreciate you putting it that way, and I can assure you everything I'm telling you is in fact true. Now, you can accept it as fact or not, it's up to you, but it's all at the website, framingpaterno.com. I want to make clear, I'm not a conspiracy person. I'm the only non-conspiracy person to look at this whole
well,
case.
The fact that you went in thinking yeah. it was guilty
right.
and it, over years and years and interviewing and talking.
So let's go back to that first allegation.
Because people call you a nut.
Yeah, I understand.
On Twitter, I just had to, I unfollowed you. You and I were texting privately.
Uh-huh.
And because anytime you and I would tweet, it's, this guy harasses the shit out of these people and he got arrested at this thing over
yeah,
here.
Right,
and I'm like,
right,
you know what? That's noise. I want the signal.
Okay.
Aaron Fisher, 2008. What was the accusation?
Okay, so,
what was the accusation?
I don't
care about the next door neighbor yet.
Okay. Well, that's important because okay. the accusation at first was not sex. It was not. Aaron Fisher doesn't come forward and say, Jerry Sandusky forced me to have sex with him or oral sex or any kind of sex. That was not the first accusation. The first several times Aaron Fisher gets interviewed by both the school and by the police, he says nothing.
Why are they interviewing him?
Because he goes to his mom, and this goes back to the neighbor. He goes to his mom and says, Jerry makes me feel uncomfortable. And the mom, according to the neighbor, who witnessed the first conversation Aaron ever had with his mom about Jerry in this light, and in great detail, and I've talked to the guy for hours and hours and hours, and I have a videotaped interview with him in which he's very clear, the mom is immediately talking money. Immediately, she says, I'm going to own that motherfucker's house. I'm going to buy a big house in the country where my dogs can roam. She now currently has four cars. Her backup car is a Porsche. Her third car is a Mercedes. Her fourth car is a Cadillac Escalade. All of which, by the way, is not her money. It's her son's money from Penn State's settlement. And if you believe her story, see, this is why this is so, the cars are important.
Yeah, I was like, I was wondering why.
Here's why the cars are important.
Okay.
If their story is true, the mom was feeding Jerry Sandusky to her son for 3 years, while according to Aaron, he was molested 100 times, which is kind of a ridiculous number when you know the best of the story. But okay, that's his final trial version of his story. His story evolved dramatically. So if you believe this story, his mom, Dawn Fisher is her name, Dawn Hennessy.
In late 2008, Dawn Hennessy, Dawn Fisher goes and she gets it going.
It is my strong belief that the only way that it makes any sense, because think about it, Jay, if you're a mom.
Hold on. It can't be this. I've read it all. This is bigger than the West Memphis 3. Damien Echols got off of death row. Mm-hmm. And what you have is more conclusive. So I'm going to interrupt you when you go, it's my belief. If the kid tells his mom, Jerry makes me feel uncomfortable, that was late 2008.
And let me tell you why he said that.
Hold on.
Okay.
And that was in late 2008?
Correct, yes.
And the mom after that continued to send the kid to Jerry Sandusky?
For a little while, yes. But most importantly, she doesn't go to the police. She goes to the school. She goes to the high school to make this claim, which is an interesting place to go. Because in my opinion, she's looking for money and deep pockets. If you're worried about that Jerry's a sexual molester, you go to the police.
Right.
You don't go to the school. The school, by the way, didn't believe her at first because they were right not to believe her.
So the accusation's in late 2008, and the mom, still in 2008, reports it to the school.
That's the first place she goes.
Okay. Now, this is fact.
Okay. Yeah, absolutely fact. It's in their book. All right.
Okay.
And by the way, I happen to believe all you have to do to understand this case, what didn't happen, is to read their book. Their book is hilarious.
There's so much fact that is so shocking.
Okay. But I want to explain the cars, Jay, real quick, because the cars are really important.
But
I
think it's a detriment to, which in my opinion would mean, because the facts that you've presented
are
airtight.
I agree with you, Jay, and I appreciate it, but I just want to just finish the point on the cars.
Sure.
Because to me, it's one of those eye-level thing that a lot of people go, wait a minute, there's no way. If you're a mom, you would have so much guilt about you not realizing that you had been sending your son, using Jerry Sandusky as a babysitter for 3 years, the night of the Jerry makes me uncomfortable. Here's why that conversation happened. Aaron didn't want to spend Saturday night with Jerry because Aaron was actually having sex with girls at this time. I know this from Aaron's best friends. He was a sex maniac, having sex with girls since he was 13 or 14 years old. He claims to have had, which is ridiculous, of course. He's actually told his friends he's had sex with 300 girls.
That's David Spade numbers.
Right. So he doesn't want to go out with old man Jerry, but his mom is already planning to go out drinking that night. And so she's forcing him, no, you're going with Jerry because I've got a big night of drinking planned. I'm sure that's not what she said, but that was her MO. So the point of this is, if this was all true and she believed it, there's not a mom in the world that would then take his money to buy not just four cars, but for luxury cars, Porsche, Mercedes, Cadillac, Escalade, because the mom guilt would be so enormous, it would prevent them from ever thinking about doing that.
What would they do with the money?
I don't know. College education.
You have kids.
I'm sorry?
You have kids?
Yeah, you would make sure your kid was taken care of for the rest of their lives.
I mean, there's human beings involved, so you don't,
right.
When they go, they judge 911 the way your voice is on a 911 call now.
Right.
Well, he's obviously not frightened enough, or he's a little too frightened, he's acting.
Let me throw in one little other fact, which is mind-blowing and really changed my view of this case. It was the first time the hair on my arms went high, like, holy fuck, Jerry's got to be innocent here, even though it doesn't prove anything directly, I think you're going to understand why I had this reaction. Aaron had a stepfather who was his father figure before Jerry came into his life. His name is Eric Daniels. After Jerry gets convicted, not long after, Eric Daniels gets arrested and convicted of 100 counts of, wait for it, child molestation. Including molestation of his own child. Now, you tell me that the mom who brought, so this mom brought that monster into the home and then allegedly had her son, fed her son to Jerry Sandusky for 3 years. So she's brought two, in her mind, if the story is true, two serial pedophiles into her home, into the home of her children, allowed one of them at least to get dramatically molested, and she's driving around in Porsches and Mercedes. Please, Jay.
I'm a parent. It doesn't make any sense to me, but I want to point this out. You say late 2008, and then the mom kept feeding Aaron Fisher to Jerry Sandusky for a little while after that. But then you also say feeding him for 3 years to Jerry Sandusky.
Three years.
Is it a little?
No. It starts when Aaron's 12.
Okay.
And then Aaron makes the allegation when he's almost 15, but he doesn't make the allegation at first. It takes him a long time. Several interviews with the police.
The mom goes to the school.
Yes.
And then she keeps going and going and going.
She's pushing it.
And then who is the first person to sit down with Aaron Fisher and say, all right, what is this?
A therapist is the first person that Aaron tells that he was molested. And it's in a reaction to a question. Did Jerry Sandusky have oral sex with you? And Aaron finally says, yes. to a therapist.
How do
a
you know?
A therapist.
How do you know?
It's written in Aaron's book.
Finally, he says it. Like, how do you know how?
Because we know all the other interviews he did before there where he makes no allegation.
The person listening to this does not know that.
Okay.
Fair so enough, right. how many interviews? How many people got to?
There was the police interview that he did. I've spoken with the police officer.
And Aaron Fisher never told the police.
Never said anything about sex. Nothing.
They asked specifically about
Jerry interviewed Sandusky. The police officer off the record for an hour and a half, and he said Aaron never said a word about sex.
And they asked him about
Jerry Sandusky. Yeah, absolutely.
So the school, the police.
And the caseworker from Child Youth Services also Aaron never said anything to. Now, it's interesting.
This is important because the entire Sandusky case is based on accuser number one, Aaron Fisher. Aaron Fisher, this begins to erode and ameliorate. So if victim number one, my dear listener, if victim number one, if this domino falls, nothing can be, you can't be accused of anything because you go up to like victim number seven. It's all based on Aaron Fisher.
And a lot of people are going to object to what you said, even though what you said is 100% true. And let me explain why it's 100% true.
Well, tell me why they would object to what I said.
Well, because they're going to say, well, what about all the other people? They can't all be lying. That's what I get a lot.
Oh, that's why I said domino.
Right. But they don't what you clearly understand, because you're a smart guy and you've read the facts here. What most people don't understand is what my theory of what happened is. And to use your domino metaphor, here's what occurs. Aaron is the only accuser in this case for 2 years, Jay. For 2 years, the investigators and the attorney general's office are looking for substantiating evidence. Other accusers, witnesses, they can find nothing. Twice, Aaron goes into the grand jury to testify. Twice, he can't testify. He literally breaks down. He can't answer a question. They have to take him off the stand. There's no indictment. There's no arrest.
He's still a minor at this point. So the prosecution has an obligation. Well, he's a minor at the time of the molestation, alleged molestation. So the prosecutor has an obligation to go forward. You can't be bought from this. You can't, as a prosecutor, if a child's been harmed, you must continue.
And it's my belief.
Forget your belief. Grand jury for a moment. Two grand juries. Mm-hmm. Ask Aaron Fisher if he was molested by Jerry Sandusky.
He can't answer the questions.
He refuses to. He's incapable.
He's basically incapable. He starts to tear up, and they have to stop the questioning. The third time he comes into the grand jury, and I've spoken to a grand juror who was there. The third time, he actually reads his testimony, which is highly unusual, with his therapist right there with him. Now, the therapist is a guy by the name of Mike Gillum, who ends up co-writing Aaron Fisher's book. And Mike Gillum is a quack. He is a quackadoodle. In fact, he's lost his state license since this story came out. If you read the book, Jay, and you'll, as a sports guy, you'll appreciate this. If you read the book, Mike Gillum's, which I urge everyone to do, I'm the only guy that urges everybody to read what the other side is saying, because if you do with an open mind, you're going to go, what the fuck is this? Mike Gillum actually alleges, among other things in the book, that the Philadelphia fucking Eagles are in on this. Because apparently the Philadelphia Eagles called Aaron at some point in the midst of all this and offered him some free tickets. So Mike Gillum believes that the Philadelphia fucking Eagles were in on this massive conspiracy in order to protect a former. It's important to understand what Jerry Sandusky is at this time. He's a former assistant college football coach only people in state college remember.
He's a former coach at this point because of child molestation.
He's not. He retired.
Okay.
He retired, which I'm happy to get into all that whole deal.
No, that's an important fact because the public narrative is he was a former coach because he was let go because he was a child molester.
Can I prove that he wasn't real quick?
He retired and he was offered like University of Virginia job.
The media likes to pretend that there's suspicion around his retirement. And there isn't. You're going to enjoy this story real quick.
Okay. Real quick, if we're going linearly.
Okay, well then let's go. I'll go. In charge. You go ahead.
No. I know the audience.
Okay.
As a parent, and a lot of people have parent of very different kids, what if Aaron Fisher was molested, and this is traumatic, and under grand jury, I go on auditions, and I don't even know the distance from one. It's just a different bananas crazy world. So what if somebody that's been molested
Right.
It's very difficult to be in front of strangers and grown-ups to go, yeah, and then he put his finger in here and he did this and he may put my mouth on that. So then by the third time, the way to get it out of a child that's been damaged is to have the therapist
That's what the prosecution thought. And I can understand why they thought that. And let me make it something clear. I've been investigating this case for 4.5 years. At the beginning, I presumed Aaron had to be telling the truth. He's the first accuser. He's the only one that came forward in his own name. He wrote a book. He did an interview with 2020. I'm thinking, I'm not even going to worry about Aaron. He must be telling the truth. Jerry must be, at some level, a pedophile. He's got to be at least somewhat guilty here. Then, partially because of what I told you about the stepdad, I go, wait a minute. This isn't adding up. So then I start to investigate Aaron, and I speak to his former girlfriends. I speak to two of his best friends that of his life who were his best friends at the time of the alleged molestation. And I go into detail on record, one on camera, one on telephone, with both of them. These are his best buds. Now they're still his friends. And you've got to remember, Aaron's rich now. So he's rich and somewhat famous. So if you're his buddy, the last thing you want to do is piss him off, right? They're both totally convinced he's not telling the truth because they knew him at the time period when the allegations occurred. They saw him with Jerry. They talked with him every day. They knew what he was like with girls. See, because they've tried to create the narrative about Aaron, that the book did, and Aaron's mother and Aaron himself have tried to create the narrative. He was an innocent, naive 13, 14-year-old boy, knew nothing about sex, and Jerry was this monster who took him under his wing and then molested him. All that's garbage. Aaron's screwing girls at an incredibly young age. And I've talked to people who tell me this directly, who've experienced
Ziegler, but having sex with girls has nothing to do with whether or not you can be groomed from all this.
Oh, no, wait a minute. Hold on a second, Jay. First of all,
I'm listening.
Right.
I'm not shooting holes.
I understand. I want you to. I want you to.
Because like I said, if you read any of John's stuff and So when you say like this guy's having sex with girls and he said he had sex with 300 girls, that like when we're talking grand jury testimony, unable to speak, and then he finally reads it next to his therapist and you talk to a policeman who said at no time did this child tell me, and when I asked him, did Jerry Sandusky ever act inappropriately with you? And Aaron Fisher tells a police officer, a caseworker, and a school, all of these people, no.
No sex, nothing, nothing actual sexual.
No molestation.
Right, correct.
Okay. So two grand juries, nothing comes out of his mouth. He kind of short circuits a bit. The third time, his therapist is next to him. He reads his testimony.
Right, right.
And that testimony says what?
That he had oral sex with Jerry Sandusky. Okay. Now, it's important to point out the timeline and the frequency, the total amount of episodes, everything changes every time he tells the story.
There's a great timeline on your website of every person in the trials, first thing they said, and the last, and you keep it up to date.
Yeah.
The website that I went to, I think was it John and Leah?
I think you're thinking, you think about there. Penn Law Fumble, I think, or framingpaterno.com?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay. So you have everyone's first statement, and there's dozens of people. And then you if something happens like a week ago, you'll bring like a statement up and there is a narrative and nothing is connecting from
right.
statement
And by the way,
one.
Let me make, and thank you for bringing that up. It's important to point out, I got a 4-year-old daughter, almost 4-year-old daughter.
You went into this thinking he was guilty.
I thought he was guilty. I want to make it clear. I am giving these accusers enormous slack. I'm not expecting perfect stories. Because, human beings are human beings. But when everything rides on you, especially when you're number one and you're only accuser for 2 years, and you change your timeline at least four times, Jay. Four times he changes his timeline, and a couple times those timelines are completely contradictory to each other. And when everything else about you doesn't make any sense, and your own friends, and let me just make it other clear. I'm not just talking about friends and girlfriends. I haven't gotten him on the record yet. I have members of his family who have indicated to me recently that they do not believe his story. They do not believe him. This is his own family members. Because he's never come close to acting like what anyone thinks of as an abuse victim. And by the way, some of these people are abuse victims themselves who are evaluating this. One of his best buddies, who's a guy who's in the military, comes to me and says, you know what really made me realize Aaron wasn't telling the truth? I'm an abuse victim myself. I think it was his granddad abused him sexually. And he had no idea that Aaron had ever been abused. And the story comes out and he goes to Aaron and he says, hey, bud, man, I'm so sorry to hear about this. This happened to me. You ever want to talk about this? I'm here for you. Aaron cuts him off. Never talks to him about it. Their relationship dissolves. Aaron doesn't want to talk to somebody who knows what the hell they're talking about on this, Jay, because he wasn't molested. He doesn't know what he's talking about. And so
you have enough legal stuff, John. Sandusky convicted of 5 counts of
45 counts. 45 counts on 10 different accusers, 8 of whom testified.
Okay. How many counts?
45 counts he was convicted on.
All right. Of?
Of 10 quote-unquote
child
accusers.
Molestation?
Yes, yes. Okay. Related to child molestation.
45 counts of child molestation, yes. Or I don't know what the word subsidiary is there for.
Right.
No witnesses.
There was the
no
Mike,
victims.
Mike McQueary. I mean.
No date and no contemporaneous reports.
That is 100% true.
Now this, like these, like how a victim might behave or might, like this.
You right. would think there would be one contemporaneous report, right? One. Just give me one. Just give me one accuser who told somebody at the time.
Who in court is saying that man sitting right there molested me? Isn't that a victim?
Sure. I mean, there were 8 people who testified that Jerry Sandusky at some level molested me. Now, a lot of this, by the way, this is important, Jay. This is really important. People think incredibly wrongly that first of all, they get the number wrong because the media misreports it. The media always reports it as 10. It was actually 8 who testified. But the media pretends that 8 people came into the courtroom and said, that man, Jerry Sandusky, butt raped me. And, you know, that wasn't the allegation. Only 2 human beings, Aaron Fisher and one other person at the time of Jerry Sandusky's arrest, had ever gone on record saying that they had a sexual act of any sort. I'm not trying to be Bill Clinton here, you know, about what the definition of sex is.
No, what you're saying now, I want to pull away from, you know, how this guy behaves and what this neighbor said. Go ahead.
So 2 people at the time of Jerry's arrest, 4 days before Joe Paterno gets fired and this whole case explodes in the national consciousness, only 2 people had ever gone on record saying Jerry Sandusky and I engaged in some semblance of a sex act. One was oral sex with Aaron Fisher, and the second, this story will knock your socks off, is victim number 4, who the media pretends and the prosecutors pretend was the star of their case once the trial came around. Well, let me tell you how victim 4 came to his story. And this is all fact, and it's all in the trial transcripts.
This is amazing.
Okay, so victim 4 is being interviewed. And for some reason, victim 4 has a lawyer with him. Now, let's think about this for a second, first of all. Why do you need a lawyer?
No. Go. Just what happened is way more powerful.
Okay, so he's there with a lawyer.
I think this is a detriment. I really do.
Okay.
Because what happened fucking blew my... It did blow my socks
okay.
off.
Well, here's what happened. So
I
he's with his
any
lawyer.
Any narrative or any like artistic license, I think, hurts this.
Okay.
Because this is
all right. I got it.
Huge.
I got it. You're right, but the media didn't treat it as huge.
I don't give a fuck about the media.
Okay.
You and I are talking, and every time you say media, you sound like a crazy person.
Okay. Well,
like every interview
you sound like my wife, but okay.
Every interview you do moving forward, when you say the media, it's like the Chris Rock joke. Like, when I go to the ATM, I ain't looking over my shoulder for the media.
Okay.
The media.
Okay, here's what happened.
Hold on. There is right and there's wrong. There was wrong. There is enough wrong that went down in this Penn State scandal that there's a guy sitting in jail as a convicted child molester 8 times over, 45 times over, that absolutely, this guy, Jerry Sandusky, can be out of jail if this gets narrowed to a succinct, without the word media in it, narrative.
Okay.
All right, victim 4.
So he's doing his interview with his lawyer there, and the investigators are trying to get him to say, did Jerry ever molest you? Did he ever have sex? And he's saying no. He's saying, no, we never had any kind of sex act, no. And So the lawyer says to the investigators, can we stop the tape? Because it's all being recorded. And the lawyer and the investigators think that they have stopped the tape, but they haven't. It continues recording. And what we get recorded is the lawyer and the investigators outside the presence of victim four conspiring. And this is not a, I'm not hyperbole, I'm not exaggerating. They're conspiring to lie to victim four. The lawyer says, hey, can we tell him that we've got a whole bunch of other people saying exactly what you want him to say so that maybe he'll go ahead and say this? And the investigators say, sure, yeah, no problem. We do this all the time.
The victim's lawyer.
Yes, the victim's lawyer.
And this is on...
It's on tape. It was played at the trial.
No, I'm not right. apoplectic. I'm right. saying this is, I'm saying it's fact. This is on tape.
Absolutely.
So yeah. Victim four is one of the only, there's two people that actually said aloud in the courtroom that man had inappropriate contact with
me. At the time of Jerry's arrest, those are the only two
so
that said there was sex.
So lawyer is talking to the authorities.
Yes.
And it's on tape.
Yes.
Where is this tape?
Well, the transcript you can see at framingpaterno.com in my online book called The Framing of Joe Paterno.
You would be a felon if any of this was made up.
You Jay, would be, no, yes,
no.
sure.
I mean,
put
no.
me in jail.
No. I mean, that's important.
No, I'm not making this up. It's all real.
I don't think you're making any of this up.
Right,
I think for the listener needs to know, right. like, if somebody thinks you're lying.
If you can prove I'm lying, I'll give you $10,000. First person to show me I'm lying about what I just said, I'll give you $10,000.
I wasn't saying it to you, yeah. like.
Yeah, I know. I get
it. You understand what you're doing here.
I get it.
I'm saying, like, if you're putting transcripts on framingjoepaterno.com for public record and it's not truthful, you'd be a felon. Like,
sure.
This is what's at risk here.
I fully accept that, and I can assure you.
I'm saying that to...
Yeah, to bolster the credibility of the story, which is 100% true. And by the way, one other thing on victim four, because to me, this goes to the absurdity of this whole case.
Oh, the police, the investigators say, sure, we do this all the time.
Yes.
I cut you off. So they stop the tape. The tape doesn't stop. Victim four's lawyer goes outside. They're still being recorded, and then go again.
So they turn back. So they think they turn the recorder back on. They tell victim four about all these other people that are allegedly saying that they had sex with Jerry, and then lo and behold, victim four comes up with a version of his story where he's finally actually having some sort of a sex act with Jerry Sandusky. Now this is critical because. To me, this is how the whole case went down, Jay. See, people think I'm alleging a massive conspiracy. I'm not. I want you to put yourself in victim four's position, okay? Victim four, who I know a lot about, like every one of these kids, was an at-risk kid, had a crappy dad, a horrible life. He's got no real great job. He's now in his 20s. And let's face it, money is money, right? So... here he's being asked about his friend Jerry Sandusky. By the way, his friend Jerry Sandusky, who he's just recently taken his kid to have dinner with at Jerry's house. That's also another important thing. So, I mean, he had dinner. He took his kid with his girlfriend to Jerry's house for dinner. People that were there literally thought he was trying to acclimate his child to Jerry so that Jerry would act like the kid's grandfather. But that's neither here nor there because you have to believe other human beings, and you have to believe me. Here's what you don't need to believe. So if you're in the position of victim four, and you're hearing these investigators, people you trust, right? These are police officers telling you Jerry had sex with other boys, and we've got other boys that are saying this, and you go, holy fuck! Jerry was always a little weird and a little bit, you know, his boundaries might be a little bit off, but I never thought he was a child molester, but. This must be real. These people are asking for my help. And by the way, my lawyer is probably giving me the wink, wink that this could be good for us down the road. So he goes ahead and he actually probably thinks he's doing a good thing.
He's helping put a child molester
away. He's helping put a child molester away. Plus maybe helping himself. So that's the key to this story. This is so important. I am not alleging, which everyone automatically presumes.
That's why I want to pull you away from right. what we were doing earlier. Yeah. Is this?
I am not alleging a massive conspiracy. I'm actually alleging one lie from Aaron Fisher with the help of his mom and Mike McQueary, the assistant coach who got so much publicity.
New name. Can we shelve it?
Yeah, being manipulated.
It's a new name, and it's going to victim four.
Yeah.
Because he's being recorded saying nothing happened.
Right.
Is that on the recording or in the transcripts? That's on framing.
I mean, he's making some. He's saying things like Jerry is handsy or inappropriate or whatever.
If the police ask you and you go in specifically about a child molestation case and you're the child and the police start asking you and you bring a lawyer, you're going to say, "Man, all right, yes." You know, there's no.
You would think. You would think.
But when your lawyer goes out in the hallway and it is recorded, like, you know, why don't we tell him that something make believe happened? Go back into the room. Hey, all your buddies did it. And this was picked up. Yahoo wrote about it. This guy, Dan Wetzel. These articles, the more I look into this, keep popping up from like 2012. Jerry Sandusky's defense bolstered by tape establishing police-led accuser's statement. 16 minutes of tape rolling while they're talking and planning how
they're
going to get victim for it rollover.
But the media, I know you hit me saying about the media, but the media downplayed that to ridiculous proportions. Most of the mentions of that tape, Jay, are at the bottom of that day's article. The bottom. Can you imagine if in the Michael Jackson trial there had been a tape like that? I mean, the entire operation would have been shut down immediately. The media would have gone bananas. So
same guy writes, Sandusky's defense doesn't refute charges, relies on character witnesses.
Well,
the way the Sandusky stuff was handled is too bizarre for words if he's not guilty. Now, I don't know how a child molester behaves.
Right.
I know how I'm not a child molester and how I behave. I don't know who you are when you're at home. You don't know who I am when I... Well, you're here now.
I'm in your home right now. Yeah. You seem pretty cool.
So, Jerry Sandusky is in jail, and you are the voice that is saying with certainty and with proof that Jerry Sandusky is a wrongly convicted man in jail. And this is, and they always say, like, hey, one guy in jail that's innocent is worse than 50 guys that are walking around guilty.
But this one's even worse, Jay, because it's not just Jerry Sandusky. Because of the nature of this case,
Joe Paterno.
It killed Joe Paterno, destroyed his legacy. There are three Penn State administrators who are still under false indictment to this day. They still haven't had a trial, although most of the charges have been dropped because they're dead innocent and the prosecution knows they're dead innocent, but there's still a couple of charges lingering. Their lives have been destroyed. Their livelihoods have been destroyed. Their reputations, the stress of living under indictment is enormous. Not to mention all the dozens of other people whose lives were destroyed and collateral damage, including, by the way, mine. You know, my marriage has been largely destroyed by this. My career has been largely destroyed by this. But I know I'm right. And so this is not just Jerry Sandusky. This is an enormous number of people, plus an entire community and a school that were wrongly convicted of something that didn't happen. And I've made this my life's passion because I don't want to live in a world where this can happen and no one has the balls to say, wait a minute, this is bullshit. Someone needs to look at this. And I'm the only one. It's basically a quirk of fate that I'm here, Jay, for better or for worse. I mean, I was probably the right person to do this, unfortunately, because of my background and who I am and my you know, all the things about me that I think made me uniquely qualified to tackle this, mainly my balls, but also the fact that, you know, I have, as I've mentioned, been a sportscaster, coached football. I've coached other sports myself, basketball, golf. I understand teenage kids a little bit. I understand the culture, and I also understand the media better than just about anybody. So I wish this hadn't been me, but this was a quirk of fate because I happened to be the guy that interviewed Jerry in prison not once but twice. And let me tell you, can I tell you the moment that I knew that I was, that Jerry was innocent? Because this is really important.
I think it is important.
So I interviewed him the first time, and I'm still convinced – all right, he's got to be somewhat guilty. This isn't making sense.
45
right,
counts.
Right. He's got to be somewhat guilty. But I'm starting to have suspicions.
45 right. people.
Well, no, not 45 people.
Oh, 45
45 counts with 10 different accusers, eight of whom actually testified, two of
Let's
whom
stick
were
to the magic
completely
number
unknown.
Here. Eight people.
Right, testified.
And eight people, okay.
So eight people testified to some level of abuse. Here's the moment. So
you knew Jerry Sandusky was not guilty of child molestation.
So after I interviewed him the first time, I go on the Today Show. And with that recorded audio that I got from the pen that I had to break to get the audio, because I was not allowed to actually record the interview.
3 hours.
So I go on the Today Show, and Matt Lauer, much to my surprise, asks me not once, not twice, but three times whether Jerry's guilty. And I don't know what to say, because honestly, I don't know the answer at that point. I'm starting to think Maybe, but I'm all, but NFL legend, Hall of Famer Franco Harris and I have become very
huge supporter of what you're doing. Franco
he's a,
Harris.
He's well, I don't want to make it very clear. He's a supporter of Joe Paterno's, and he and I have worked very hard together on this. Okay.
Okay. My so, me speaking, Jay Mohr. The words that have come out of Franco Harris's mouth, if you go to framingjoepaterno.com, this is not edited or jostled or cajoled or couched in a way where Franco Harris, Hall of Famer, Pittsburgh Steeler, Sixburg baby. This wasn't like, and then it got edited really weird, so it looks like Franco Harris is saying this. This is, these are standalone statements.
Right.
By very, these, okay.
Franco Harris, I want to be very honest, Jake. This has been a very, very rough 5 years for me. Because one of the things that has happened is that I have gotten a very dim view of humanity because of looking at this story, a very dim view of humanity. Franco Harris is one of a handful of people that have allowed me to remain remotely sane with my view of humanity. He is a mountain of a man, a guy who, by the way, I hated as a Philadelphia Eagle fan growing up outside of Philadelphia because he always ran out of bounds, and you know, I hated the Steelers.
You watch your fucking mouth when you talk that way about Franco Harris and his house. Well, he's a Catholic. Okay. Watch your body.
But Jay, let me make something clear.
You watch your filthy
mouth. Let me make something clear.
He's half Italian, half black. That's a hustle, man.
I understand, Jay. Let me make something clear. The Franco Harris I know now, I would take two bullets for. I would take two bullets for Franco Harris, and I have often, to him, jokingly referred to myself as his Rocky Blyer. I will take the hits. I'll open the holes. I'll suffer the consequences. I'll give up my own body. I don't even want any credit. You just run through the holes once I make them. So Franco's a big Joe Paterno supporter. He does not believe that Jerry Sandusky got a fair trial. But the point of going back to the story, Franco had made it clear to me, hey, look, if when you do these interviews after interviewing Jerry, we can't be saying Jerry is innocent, because that's going to lose the whole, everyone's going to lose their minds. They're going to think you're insane. And because of my loyalty to Franco, I told Matt Lauer, I said, I think Jerry is guilty of some or most of what he's convicted of, but that his trial had huge due process problems, which was a fairly accurate statement. But I knew I needed to put that to bed so that I could remain credible in fighting this Joe Paterno fight. Anyway, for the next year, I'm investigating whether or not it's possible that not only Joe Paterno is innocent, but Jerry Sandusky is innocent. Because I'm not going to go public with this unless I'm fucking sure. As part of being sure,
you got a baby on the way at this point.
What's that?
At this point in the timeline, you have a baby on the way.
Actually, I have a baby who just been already arrived.
Arrived.
I have a newborn.
Now you're a dad.
Yeah, I know a dad.
So
yes.
If anything, you'd be more hardened.
Yes.
And not going, well, hold on a minute. You know, we've all sort of.
I agree with that. I think that's a good point. It's interesting that my child is almost exactly as old as this story. But anyway, the point here's one of the points. So as part of confirming my suspicions, I write to Jerry. I said, Jerry, I want to interview you and your wife Dottie together in prison. And I'm doing this for two reasons. One, I have a whole bunch of other questions I want to ask, but two, I want to see if he'll do it. Because if Jerry is guilty, his wife Dottie, who comes to visit him every week, drives 3.5 hours each way once a week to see him, is his only light, his only supporter at this point. So, and he also knows me. He knows I don't give a fuck. And so if he's opening himself up to me having him and Dottie together, I might be saying, Jerry, you're guilty, and here's how I know it. And by the way, when I leave that prison cell, Dottie's coming with me. So in other words, Jerry's incredibly vulnerable if he's guilty. So if he says no...
This is pre-trial.
No, this is way after he's been convicted.
He's been convicted.
He's in prison. This is the second time I'm going back.
Yeah, okay.
But his only light of his life is his wife, Dottie.
Right.
So I'm thinking the first step here is if he agrees or not. Because if he doesn't agree to do it, then he must be guilty of something. He says, sure, you and Dottie come in and we'll do this together. I'm like, okay. That doesn't prove it, though, because I still need to come in and ask him some questions. So I say to both of them, I say, could you guys tell me when was the first moment that you thought this all might not work out okay for you? Now, I'm asking that question in that way very specifically because if he's guilty, there's 1,000 moments in this story where he's going, oh, shit, they got me, right? And here he is with, he's in handcuffs and the orange jumpsuit. His hands are down by his waist because they're tied there. He can't even scratch himself. The tears start coming down his cheeks. He's bawling. And he tells me in great detail about how at the reading of the verdicts was the first time he thought, oh my gosh, this isn't going to work out. I turn to Dottie. She's bawling more than Jerry is. And his wife says in even greater detail, expressing exactly how she felt at the same moment, which was the reading of the verdicts, that this was the first time, oh my gosh, this might not work out. It's important to point out, they are both exceedingly very religious people. They're very Christian. They thought God was going to take care of them here. So I'm not at this point, I'm not 1,000% convinced, but I'm getting close. So I need to confirm that this isn't some sort of amazing ruse that I'm being put under. So I immediately get out of the prison and I call their lawyer, Joe Amendola. And I say, Joe, I just asked Jerry and Dottie, when was the first moment that you thought this might not work out okay for you? What do you think they said? And Joe thinks about it for 3 or 4 seconds and he says, was it the reading of the verdicts? And I'm like, there you go. That's an innocent guy right there. Especially when all the facts, you know, it's important to point out that that in a vacuum wouldn't do it. This is in the context of all the facts that I now know, where the narrative that we were sold doesn't make a damn bit of sense. You follow me, Jay?
I do follow you. In a case like this, if there's 8 accusers, can something be mistrialed if victim 4, victim 1, let's say 2 of them, you realize that audio recording where a child was coerced, and you can read the transcripts at framingjoepaterno.com. I put my name on this site. It's nuts what's happening and what went down. And I'm not a fucking conspiracy guy, but I'm only dealing with facts, court transcripts, dot. I don't give a fuck what a neighbor thinks. I'm saying this to the listener.
I understand.
I don't give a fuck. Like, well, he would have acted like this. No. If a lawyer goes outside who's representing a kid and they all conspire, like, how about we try this? And they go back in and they try that. And then the kid flips. In this type of a case, John, and I'm genuinely asking you because I don't know.
Sure.
If something like that comes to light during the trial, is that a hole in the boat? Like in a murder trial, for example,
sure.
It's like, no, you got that out of my house. You didn't have a fucking warrant for my car though.
Yeah.
And you took that. So like searching my car illegally. Now I'm mistrialed. I'm off the hook.
In a normal case, Jay, this victim 4 tape would have been enormous. I mean, the police were proven to have lied on the stand.
Normal case. No.
But this is not a normal case.
No. The law. Not normal, abnormal, not media.
Well,
the law. If this was a court of law, because I don't know about when children are.
Well, here, I'll give you what happened in the case.
I know what you mean by normal.
I'll give you what happened in the case. This was extraordinary to me. So the judge... judge admonishes the jury about this tape and says, get this. I'm paraphrasing, but it's pretty darn accurate. The judge says,
this is all documented.
Yeah.
So the judge, I don't know. I need the listener to know. No, this is not a crackpot
right.
sitting in my
you
house.
You can find it in the transcripts
going
if you want.
Like, hey, George Bush flew fucking planes into the towers.
I hate
like,
conspiracy people.
No,
I hate them. Okay.
This is
all, right, so anyway,
this
here,
all documented.
Here, so the judge, in light of this tape thing, the judge actually admonishes the jury to only use the tape to evaluate the credibility of the police and not the victim. He specifically tells the jury, do not hold the tape against the victim.
That would work for Sandusky either way.
Because what the judge is telling the jury there
I know
is,
what he's telling them.
Yeah.
But the credibility of the police that were there is incredibly in question.
You would think
they
so.
They conspired.
I mean, absolutely. Plus, so they lied
juror,
on the stand. They
but,
lied about it on the stand, too. So, but you would, but see.
That's a big statement you made there, buddy.
They did.
People
I'm
get
not,
racked for stuff
I'm
like
fine.
That.
Go, come after me. Come after me. But the so point, the point God. Is, the point
God
is, the.
Me, I'm a man.
But Jay, the point is that the jury, as long as they believed these accusers, nothing else mattered. Because this was a community that was being accused of having covered up for a child molester. It was their civic duty to convict Jerry Sandusky. People forget about the pressure that was on this jury. Jay, there were hundreds of people outside the courthouse cheering for Jerry to be convicted. This was the Salem fucking witch trial. I mean, this was 7 months after the firing of Joe Paterno, the most famous and revered man in the state of Pennsylvania. This was 5 months after his death, which Jerry got obviously blamed for. And so the atmosphere was Salem witch trial like.
If you live in this community and you think a person molested children, there's eight people taking the witness stand. That's exactly what a community would do.
Of course, in this, but especially in this case, Jay, because the whole community was being accused of having covered up for him.
Yes, and this is children being groomed, children being vetted, children being sent to Mr. Sandusky, and then the shame of the community themselves of being silent partners without their knowing about it. Of course, they're going to rush and start screaming. So I don't think that's unique here.
It was exaggerated here. This was on steroids here, Jay.
Well, if you think a guy molested children, you're going to stand outside.
But most cases don't have this much, anywhere near this much publicity, and the Joe Paterno angle isn't involved. See, Joe Paterno is the father of the entire community. It's like everyone lost their father because of Jerry Sandusky.
You're in court. Tell me one thing that gets Jerry Sandusky just thrown out of jail. If the cameras are in, you told me on the phone, if cameras are in the courtroom, he never goes to jail. What did the cameras say? It says, we love clickbait in this country.
Well, you can't prove this case in a headline. That's the problem.
You have to put doubt.
I mean, I think that there was a perfect storm here in so many ways, but no cameras in the courtroom allowed.
What happened in the courtroom where this would not have gone as far as it gone?
Well, the tape of victim four's story, that would be the biggest, easiest bombshell.
I agree with you. The question remains, I don't know the answer to.
Okay.
And the tape of victim four is like, well, you can't, that's illegal. Does that toss out 2-1?
Well, three? Jerry's appeal is still ongoing. On May 20th, there's going to be an open hearing to deal with several of the issues that the defense has raised in what is called post-conviction relief. Now, what's important to note, almost everything we're talking about here is only relevant if there's ever a second trial, because what happens in post-conviction relief is a very, very technical process. It has almost nothing to do with whether or not you're guilty or innocent. It has to do with whether or not your trial was valid. But here's the catch, Jay. This is how fucked up this whole thing is. The judge who is overseeing post-conviction relief is the same judge who oversaw the first trial. So in order for there to be a new trial, this judge would have to invalidate the most important, most famous trial of his entire career. He's not going to do that.
You are an attorney.
I'm not, but okay.
No.
Although Jerry has said he wishes that I had given his closing argument.
You are an attorney. I'm a member of the jury. I'm the lone holdout on this jury. You have to tell me where I cannot put a man in jail for the rest of his life in this trial with these eight people that testified. Where was the non-fair trial? I know it's very difficult because of the enormous amount of, there's 52.
Well, if I was in charge of his appeal, and I've told his lawyer this.
Just me. You're in charge of convincing me.
That he didn't get a fair trial or that he's innocent?
Did Jerry Sandusky, yes or no? Did Jerry Sandusky get a fair trial?
No, and here's why.
Hold on. I'm the guy putting him in jail. I'm the last holdout.
Yeah.
Tell me why.
Here's how he didn't get a fair trial. The governor of
By law.
I know, by law. Okay. And this, I think, ought to be his best appeal issue, and I've told Jerry's lawyers this, and they begrudgingly agreed with me. Here's the legal issue. When Joe Paterno was fired, he was fired because of a vote in which the governor of the state of Pennsylvania, the governor of the state, by the way, happened to be the attorney general who
What's that to do with Jerry Sandusky?
No, you're going
to,
I'm getting
I'm
it.
About to put a guy in jail for the rest of his life.
No, you're asking me why the trial was invalid.
Okay.
It was invalid because a state actor, the governor, voted and urged others to vote to fire Joe Paterno. Once you fire Joe Paterno, who is a key witness in the case, and the accused former boss, you create an atmosphere where his constitutional rights are inherently violated because you cannot have a fair trial under those circumstances. So a state actor, the governor of the state, created a circumstance by the firing of Joe Paterno that made it impossible for there to be a fair trial for Jerry Sandusky. That's a violation of his constitutional rights. That's his violation. The state acted in a way to purposely destroy his right to, or his ability to have a fair trial in a community that was completely enraged by all this. So because the governor did that, that to me is proof that the state acted in a way to purposely cause Sandusky to not be able to get a fair trial. Now, you want to ask me why he's innocent.
What if the state pushed Joe Paterno out because there's guys that get fired all the time that had nothing to do with cheating, nothing to do with grades, hooker parties in college. Mm-hmm. Rick Pitino has a job in Louisville, I have no idea, in his very specific phrase. That governor could look at you, John Ziegler, and say, lack of institutional control. Yeah. Whether this happened or didn't happen, the fact that this shitstorm is happening in the Keystone State that I was elected to represent, you got to go. This is a lack of institutional control.
But here's the proof of that's not accurate.
Okay.
3 days before he's fired, an attorney general source gives the woman who ended up winning a Pulitzer Prize, which was invalid in this case, a woman by the name of Sarah Ganim.
Stuff like that kills you. Is it really invalid?
I'd talk for hours about why it's not, but you're right.
Does she still have it in her home?
Yeah, she still has it in her home.
That stuff kills you.
Okay, Jay, all right. Okay, let me rewind. So there was an article on November 5th.
You know why, Johnny? Because I know how much work you've put into this. The things that I've read
Fair enough, I get it, Jay.
This needs to be said. The things that are factual court documents, the things that cannot be refuted, the things that are letter of the law. We got an election cycle going on. Everybody's jacking off to the Constitution. Right. Like the Constitution, right. And it is, there are a set of laws and things have been violated, ignored, and people have changed their stories and it's all been forgotten about. But you, John, having put so much time and energy into this, and this story, by the way, is the most abhorrent story to go against, so that every step of the way, you're getting kicked in the fucking balls.
Yes.
That when you, it becomes personal.
Right.
And this is so personal to you because you went into it thinking Jerry Sandusky is completely guilty. And you came out the other end through logic and fact checking and interviews and re-interviews and re-interviews. So these people that come the other way against you, it's fucking personal. Like you mentioned your marriage.
Yes.
You have a child.
Yes.
That's a product of a marriage that is not ideal, as you said.
Right.
But then when you can't play that that side of the court, because it makes people that don't believe you not have a reason to lean.
Okay.
Remember I texted you? I'm leaning towards you, John. I specifically use those words. You are such a small voice in this cacophony of fucking witch trial. Yeah,
right.
Fuck it, Paterno knew,
right.
I'm one of those voices. Two Fridays ago,
I got it.
Fucking shut it down. I said on a nationally syndicated radio.
And you deserve a lot of respect for being open-minded.
I want to find the truth.
Right. You can't handle
it. I can handle the truth.
Well, thank you.
So it's personal to you because this has been your life. And
I get it.
People are telling you that your facts are incorrect. That would make anybody bananas.
Okay.
That's why I'm like, her prize and this guy and this fucking
loon. So here's what Sarah Ganim.
He's a fucking quack. Like, no. Nothing. Just.
Here's what she reported. And this proves that the idea that Paterno was the problem, it was a fraud. On November 5th, 4 days
and before, I said on my radio show, he knew.
Well, here's the proof.
And you told me I was wrong. And you can prove.
If there's one article that proves the whole thing about Paterno, it's this. On November 5th, 4 days before he gets fired, the day Jerry Sandusky is arrested, Sarah Ganim, the Pulitzer Prize winning journalist, uses an attorney general source and writes a headline. Listen to this carefully, folks, because this is mind-blowing in retrospect. Joe Paterno praised for his handling of Jerry Sandusky sex abuse suspicions. And the source of the article is from the Attorney General's office of the state of Pennsylvania, the same Attorney General's office that Tom Corbett, the governor, used to run when the investigation began. Paterno was their star witness, Jay.
They're feeding themselves for the benefit of the thing. Yeah.
He was their star.
That's like Dick Cheney planning the story.
He was their star witness. And that leads us, I think, to the key episode, which I hope we'll talk at least a little bit about, because it's the one that most people know about, which is the whole Mike McQuarrie thing.
Okay, but we're going to. In the courtroom, the governor I, as a juror, can say, well, it's a lack of institutional control. You know, this is everyone, like everyone has to go. Like I would do that as an analytics person looking at the entire situation. I would say, you got to go like this. We got to just clear the goddamn decks. This is fucking nuts. Everybody out, fresh blood.
That's what they did because they didn't have any facts. Everyone panicked. This was a pure panic, Jay.
I've read on framingjoepaterno.com. Framingjoepaterno.com.
It's actually framingpaterno, but okay.
Framing. Go find it. Framingpaterno.com. 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 I have read so many things that happened in this trial that if there were cameras in the courtroom, this would all, the guy just wouldn't be in jail. You have the ability to get Jerry Sandusky out of
but
jail.
But at this point, there has to be a technical, legal, not fact-based, not truth, innocence, or guilty. It has to be a technical problem with the first trial that the judge who oversaw that trial looks at and goes, you know what? I'm going to invalidate the most important trial I ever oversaw. Now, he might do that on May 20th because there's some new evidence that indicates that there were grand jury leaks by the government in this case, which the current attorney general apparently is willing to testify to. If that's all true, then on a legal grounds, he has a new trial, Jay, because if the government purposely leaked grand jury information, which I think the evidence is overwhelming that they did, if they did that, that invalidates the trial, period. So that might be his silver bullet, but Jay, I just don't believe that this judge is going to have the balls.
No, the judge
to
won't.
Do this.
It's the same thing that happened with like Damian Eccles. It's the
There's
same.
There's no way.
It's the same
There's
judge,
no
the
way.
Same prosecutor. So during Sandusky's trial, you don't think they're to the detriment of your argument, maybe that you don't think there's something that like on a Law and Order episode they would go, this is you can't do this in a courtroom. This is a mistrial.
Well, I'll give you another example. This will lead us to McQuarrie.
Because I can go to the website.
No, I'll give you... Here's another issue that Jerry's lawyers are using, which leads us to McQuarrie. The prosecution claimed that the boy in the McQuarrie episode was known only to God. That's what they said. They told the jury that the boy in the McQuarrie... Because there was no one who testified as the victim in the McQuarrie episode. Isn't that odd, Jay? The media never found that curious. But here's the most important, most publicized act of alleged child molestation in the history of the world. Penn State's making clear they're going to pay victims. It only happened in 2001. It was only a 10-year-old story. So the idea that somehow the kid is dead is ridiculous.
How do we go back from 2008 to 2001?
No. 2001 is when the McQuarrie episode occurs. And so Jerry's on trial in 2012, 11 years later. And so the prosecution tells the jury, you know, we didn't have anybody testify as a victim in that Mike McQuarrie episode. But that's because, and this is a direct quote, the identity of that victim is known only to God. Now, that's important. That's incredibly important. By the way, they knew that was a lie. This is Jerry's appeal issue, is that the prosecution knowingly lied to the jury because they wanted to try to explain why no victim testified in that episode. Because here's what really happened.
Is that ever used as code for anonymous? Like, hey, man, he's only sleeps with the fishes, like dead for the mob. Like, no, I really don't know.
You can interpret what was said in any way you want.
No. I'm not punching holes in this.
No, I get it.
I'm asking, have you ever heard that before?
That's a weird phrase to use, but the point...
It's so weird that it would stick out in your mind had you heard
it. The point, I have not heard it elsewhere.
That's all I wanted to know.
But the point, though, is, Jay, they were telling the jury, this person, we don't know who this person is. We have no idea.
Oh, that's a horse of a different color.
Okay, they were saying, we don't know who this person is.
We don't know who the accuser and the victim is. The prosecution is saying, this person that came to us.
And that was a lie, because they did know who it was.
Well, how could you not know if they...
And let me tell you who it was, and let me tell you why they knew.
I'm standing with you, looking out at the masses here.
Uh-huh.
So I don't want you to be defensive. I'm saying, how could you not know who the victim is if you're the prosecution, if the victim has to... Be with the prosecution in order to prosecute Jerry Sandusky for said victim.
Well, it's a good question. So let me tell you what happened. Here's how they knew, and here's why they claim they didn't know. Okay? They knew because someone did come forward as the kid who was in the shower that night when Mike McQuarrie, the Penn State assistant coach, allegedly saw something going on for 2 or 3 seconds by his own testimony through a mirror, by the way, not even directly into the shower.
This is testimony.
This is his testimony. You can look it up for yourself. I'm not misquoting it.
No, okay, I'm so, just letting the listener know everything you're saying is testimony.
So there was a guy who came forward. His name is Alan Myers. He came forward on the day Joe Paterno was fired, Jay. And he came into Jerry Sandusky's lawyer's office with his mother as a 24-year-old sergeant in the Marine Corps. Now, I think that's important because when you're married and you're a sergeant in the Marine Corps, that's a level of maturity, toughness. It tells you about what your principles are, what your value system is. And you come in the middle of a shitstorm of unprecedented proportions. And you come into Joe Amendola's office and you say, I want to make a statement. And so Joe Amendola's FBI-trained former police officer investigator sits down with Alan Myers and takes his statement. And he says, I'm the guy who was in the shower with Jerry Sandusky the night Mike McQuarrie is saying he saw us. And let me tell you what really did and did not happen. And he goes into enormous detail. The statement is on my website, framingpaterno.com. So I wave this statement on the Today Show, on CNN. No one in the media gives a damn. It's on our website, framingpaterno.com. But in the statement, he couldn't be more clear. He couldn't be more detailed, saying, I'm the kid. He says at least two things that only on that date, March 9th, 2011, the kid in the McQuarrie episode could possibly know. Two things. One, he talks about the locker door being slammed by Mike McQuarrie. And two, he talks about Jerry Sandusky telling him a couple weeks later that Penn State might contact him to talk about this. There is no possible way someone else would have known those things because they were not publicly known, nor were they publicly accessible. Impossible. Not to mention, the rest of his story is so detailed, and who else would come in and say this if it wasn't true? And by the way, importantly, very importantly, no one else has ever claimed to be that kid. And that's worth millions of dollars to be that kid. So he makes this statement. Joe Amendola, Jerry's attorney, thinks, holy shit, case is over. We just blew McQuarrie out of the water. We got the kid. This thing is done. Well, that night, Joe Paterno gets fired. The president of Penn State gets fired. There's riots on the campus of Penn State. The whole fucking world changes. The next morning in Business Insider, there's a headline, Penn State on the hook for $100 million for the accusers of Jerry Sandusky. Every trial lawyer in the fucking state is now all over this. And as fate would have it, Jay, one of those trial lawyers is a guy by the name of Andrew Shubin, who would end up representing 9 accusers in this case. Andrew Shubin had previously represented Alan Myers in not one but 2 DUIs. And Alan Myers' mother had worked for Andrew Shubin in his office, I believe, as a secretary. Well, that connection turned out to be very lucrative for both of them. Because what ends up happening is Andrew Shubin contacts Alan, finds out that Alan is the kid in the McQuarrie episode, and offers him, I'm sure, free representation. Shubin calls Amendola and says, I want you to know I'm representing Alan Myers. At first, Joe's like, cool. Joe, you know, Alan will probably need representation. Andrew Shubin says to Joe, no, Joe, you don't understand. Alan's a victim. And Joe's like, oh, fuck. Alan flipped. Alan flipped because he saw the money. He had no job because of the 2 DUIs. He was out of the Marine Corps.
These are public people now.
Yes.
So private citizens, but this is a very public thing.
Please sue me. Please sue me.
No, that's not what I'm getting at all, is that this guy, Alan.
Yeah.
All you have to do is look at the statement to Joe Amendola and the statement to Andrew Shubin and say, wait a minute, you're my neighbor. You gave, like if he lived next door to me here, next time I'm walking the dogs, my 3 little knuckleheads, I'd go, hey, I don't know if, these are 2, you gave 2 completely separate.
Well, that's why I've been using his name every chance I get. I've been to his house. He wasn't home. I talked to his wife. I've had an investigator come to his house who did talk to him.
Is the end game for you just this? Because you're not getting famous off of this in any positive way whatsoever. You've been vilified.
I've lost money.
I've been told to not give you the time of day.
I'm sure you have.
What people don't realize is the more you tell me that, the more I go, okay, because it's the fucking internet.
Right.
Where people tell me terrible things about myself.
Jay, if I was telling a lie, would people bother to try to destroy me like this?
I'm surprised you're alive.
Are you really?
The things that you have on framing.paterno.com, this, and by the way, well, it's like an hour, not one word media. Well done. And I'm being serious. The things that you have on, you haven't flipped this juror.
Okay.
The governor, lack of institutional control, I can go, you know.
Well, you asked for a technical reason.
Well, that's the only thing that's going
to
get him out.
No, but the McQuarrie episode to me shows innocence. So if we can go through this.
But there's eight accusers, I only need one. Like victim number nine weeping and crying on the stand and saying, Jerry said to soil himself. Yeah, of course I want you to. I just want to
tell people what it is. Yes.
Victim number nine is crying on the stand, weeping, and Jerry would tell victim number nine, go to the bathroom in your pants, throw them in the garbage, that way there's no evidence of what we've done here. Weeping, crying.
Right.
If I'm a juror, I only need one of these eight to put
to
Jerry
believe.
Away.
Sure, absolutely.
Not to believe, to go, there's no reasonable
doubt. And by the way, don't you think it's a little weird that all these guys were allowed to be part of the same trial? Shouldn't they have gone on individual trials, by the way? I mean, that's a totally separate issue.
I don't know.
But to me, from a fairness standpoint, they should have been separate trials.
If I'm the prosecutor, it's almost like they did overkill.
Oh, they had
because I would have, to have an airtight case, taken victim number nine, or just, I would have vetted, Aaron Fisher, I would have tossed. Yeah. I would have tossed number four, certainly.
Okay. Can I tell the story of nine?
I would have chosen a victim and done separately, like you said, because all I need is...
Is one.
One. Right. To make 12 people
they knew not one of them was a deadlock cinch.
Nine's pretty tough.
Okay,
man.
Let me talk to you about nine, because number nine is a joke. It's important to point out that of all of the accusers that come forward after Joe Paterno's firing, which is the key moment in this whole case, because after Joe's fired, Penn State's on the hook. Everybody knows it. It's money. Okay, so if you come forward after Joe Paterno's firing, in my opinion, Jay, you're automatically a little suspicious because you didn't come forward. There was plenty of time for you to come forward before that. This was in the local papers in March of that year.
You go the other way with it, though, John. You could say, I'm going to go forward because now that Joe's dead, I'm not disrespecting Joe and the legacy he's built.
But just
tell me about number nine.
Okay, here's number nine.
You have so much fact.
Okay, he comes forward after Joe Paterno's fired. In his first story, he says nothing about sex. His eventual story is he was getting anally raped brutally by a Jerry Sandusky that sounds totally different than what every other accuser claimed.
First story
was nothing happened. Nothing.
Was to whom?
I believe it was to an investigator. Said nothing ever happened. And so
nothing happened to brutally. Is this on record? The word. Say anal.
Number nine is by far the worst testimony.
That's why I brought him up.
I mean, number nine is if it's real, it's by far the most disgusting. It's by far the most brutal. But interestingly, it's completely inconsistent with what every other accuser said. He's the only one, Jay, and I know people don't want to talk about this. He's the only person who got up on the stand and said, I got anally raped by Jerry Sandusky. He's the only one. Now, interestingly, you can be tested medically for whether or not you've ever been anally raped. It's very easily done, and it's very conclusive. There was never any test. He never took any tests.
I didn't know that.
Okay. Think about it.
Let's say if I'm a homosexual male and I have anal sex, or if I have anal sex with my wife or something.
Any doctor would be able to prove that.
If it's a violation, they can tell?
Absolutely.
Okay.
And so he never had that test. But that's not even the best evidence against him. So he comes forward after Joe Paterno's firing. He denied anything in his first story. He's the only one claiming anal rape. In my opinion, he's simply mimicking what was reported in the McQuarrie allegation, and that's why he comes up with that story. But here's what we also know. He's claiming that this happened in the basement of Jerry Sandusky's house, and that he's screaming for help while Dottie is in the house. Okay? Now, when people have in their minds, they might think the Sanduskys live in this enormous mansion and, you know, maybe there's...
Oh, these are, yeah, Western Pennsylvania.
This is a small house.
Yeah.
When Matt Lauer came to Dottie Sandusky's house to do an interview with me and Dottie Sandusky for the Today Show, he went downstairs in that basement. He specifically asked to go into that basement guest room. And he was stunned about, I mean... You can literally hear a pin drop in the kitchen from the basement guest house. Yeah. It is 8 feet up a flight of stairs to the kitchen where Dottie is cooking. You can hear anything. If anyone's saying anything in that room, you can hear it on the second floor. Yeah. Even Matt Lauer was like, really? Seriously? There's no possible way, not to mention that this would mean that Dottie knows he's guilty, and I've dealt with Dottie through thick and thin, and Dottie and I have had our battles. I mean, we have battled each other. We've hung up on each other. She's the church lady. She hates it when I curse, and so you know, she's hung up on me when I curse. I'm very critical of some of the things they've done and not done. I am not enamored with these people at all, but she is not an enabler for child sex abuse. She is positive Jerry is innocent. She drives 7 hours each week in a jalopy with 160,000 miles on it to go visit him in prison for 3 hours. So the point is, number nine story is ridiculous. It's inconsistent with everybody else. And get this, Jay, this might be the most convincing thing. So on the dates that number nine gives, and by the way, no one in this case gives specific dates ever. They're always like, yeah, it was weekends in the fall, or it was, you know.
McQuarrie
got the date wrong. Okay.
Pre-9/11, post-9/11.
Right, okay, right. We'll get to that. But the point is, he doesn't give us any specific dates, but he says weekends during these years.
This is victim number nine.
Number nine says, I was molested in Jerry's house on weekends during these years.
Well, annually raped in the basement. I screamed as loud as I could for somebody to come save me.
Here's the problem.
Okay.
He gives the same years and weekends as Aaron Fisher claims to have been at the Sandusky house. And they never knew each other. They never met each other. Not only does this make Jerry the marathon man of all sex abusers.
That's what you tell me as the juror.
Okay.
As a juror, when you tell me that Aaron Fisher, late 2008, now this guy that comes after Joe Paterno got victim number nine, same exact day, same exact time. That's impossible.
Absurd.
At least Aaron Fisher would go, yeah, he raped this guy. I heard him screaming because he was sitting next to me.
Or they would at least meet. They would at least meet.
And the cross-examination was just inept? Or is it just because it's child molestation? You obviously, if somebody was molested, you have to err on the side of extreme caution.
You have to remember that 2 days after Joe Paterno was fired, there's a candlelight vigil for these victims at Penn State, and 10,000 people or more show up with candles for these victims. There's a prayer for them before the next football game.
What I saw on TV was at a very specific location. It was outside Joe Paterno's house.
Well, there was that. I mean,
that was live on the worldwide leader.
I'm speaking
for pro you.
I know
that this is now ramping up.
Yeah. These guys were untouchable, Jay. They were untouchable. You could not question them. You could not question them.
You're talking about Penn State?
No, the accusers. The accusers were sanctified immediately as basically having halos over their head, and that you were a pedophile enabler if you even questioned them, because no one lies about this, Jay. No one. Well, I'm sorry.
Cross-examination is the place for questions.
Well,
it seems like inside that courtroom.
Joe Amendola did a decent job under very, 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 very difficult circumstances.
This was a jury trial, right?
I think Joe was a little intimidated. I think he was definitely overwhelmed. There were no continuances in this trial, which is unheard of. It was over 7 months after Jerry gets arrested in this atmosphere of the Salem witch trial.
Joe Amendola ask victims 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, or 8, were you sexually molested by this man sitting right here?
I don't think Joe would have done that because that's something the prosecution would ask.
Well, no, if I'm Joe, that's what I'm...
Because I think all...
Because
of them,
if they say yes, I'm going to go, okay, when, how, right. keep going.
Right.
That's the same date as Aaron Fisher. Wait, hold on.
Well, this was brought up. I mean, and Joe did bring up the issue of number 9 and number 1 being there at the same time and not knowing each other. That was absolutely brought up in both the testimony as well as the closing arguments.
Let's take number 9 and say... Okay. It's almost like vetting a jury, right? Number 9, that story, there's no way this could happen at the same time. You're excused. Now, we're at 8.
Oh, to me,
like
I agree with that philosophy.
It's a Herculean task to walk this all the way back to this.
Unless you understand the theory of the case, which was that it's all about two people, Jay. It's about Aaron Fisher and Mike McQueary. Those are the pillars of this case. The one witness, Mike McQueary, the first accuser, Aaron Fisher. Those two pillars, I thought, and everyone else thought at the time of this story in 2011, were built of stone or steel. They're not. They're built of sand. Those pillars are sand, Jay, and they've disintegrated. And when those pillars collapse, the whole case collapses. Because here's what the prosecution did. Once they get Fisher and McQueary, they take those two stories and they go to, let's say, 100 former Second Mile members, the charity of Jerry Sandusky for at-risk kids. So they go into a pool of men who are all from horrible backgrounds. They don't have dads. They were probably abused themselves. They probably don't have jobs. They're probably poor. They go into a pool of very troubled lives. And they go to each and every one of them and they go, "We want to talk to you about Jerry Sandusky. We think he might be a child molester. We got a guy, Aaron Fisher, who's saying that he was molested for 3 years. We got a former Penn State current Penn State coach, Mike McQueary, who says he saw Jerry molest a boy. Can you help us here?" And 95-some% say, "No, Jerry's the greatest thing that's ever happened to me." But when you go into a pool like that, Jay, you're going to catch a couple of fish. You're going to catch a couple that go, "You know what? Yeah, tell me more about this. Maybe something happened. I can kind of remember Jerry getting an erection in the shower we took together that one time. I can kind of remember Jerry slapping me on the ass that one time. Yeah, does that count? Is that good enough for you?" And that's how this whole thing evolves to the point where you get the victim number 4 story that we talked about earlier. And by the way, one other thing on 9, because to me this is one of those eye-level things that a lot of people go, "Okay, now I get it's full of shit." Victim 9, when he went to go get his settlement from Penn State, and the settlements have been in huge in the news the last week or so, which I hope we'll talk about. When he went to go get his settlement from Penn State, he had a problem. Because his allegation was at Jerry's house. It wasn't at Penn State.
That's a problem.
Well, so
Penn State's not liable for a former coach in his private home.
In theory, you're right. So what does number 9 do? Number 9 tells Penn State that in 2005, well after Jerry has retired, that Jerry Sandusky, Joe Paterno, and Victim 9 all had lunch together at Beaver Stadium, and that, in his opinion, Joe Paterno knew what Jerry Sandusky was doing to him. And shazam. This is after the trial.
Okay.
So shazam, victim number 9 gets a settlement from Penn State.
Now, from Penn State.
That's an absurd story, okay? People have to understand. That is an absurdity. Joe Paterno didn't even like Jerry Sandusky, okay?
We do understand.
Okay.
But if I'm Penn State and I'm already on the hook and I'm going down like, this is Catholic Church level pedophilia scandal, but it's football, it's Americana, it's Joe Pa, there's statue. If I'm Penn State, that's my only shot to say, "You got to get the fuck off my lawn. Get out of here." No.
You're thinking rationally. First thing you have to understand is it's not their money. The people that are making these decisions, it's not like Penn State's a corporation or an individual. It's a state school that is presuming that the insurance company is going to cover them.
That's what's happened in the last week.
All these stories are bull crap because they're just like Victim 9's story where he attaches himself to Joe Paterno because that's the way you got Penn State money. And so the people giving it away, Jay, they have no accountability. They want this whole thing to go away. And in fact, bizarrely, Jay, you got to remember, the same people giving away the money are the exact same people who fired Joe Paterno. They want Paterno to be culpable of something, because if he's not, they fired him incorrectly. And for all time, they will be damned for having destroyed the most honored and famous and beloved man in the history of the state for no reason. So they have an incentive. See, people don't understand the incentives in this case, Jay. Penn State has an incentive to condemn themselves, because it's a good, in the media's world, it's a good PR move. It's self-flagellation. Oh, woe is us. We did so horrible. We did terrible things. We're going to give away $90-some million as our penance, when in fact, it's all bullshit.
But something has to start that wheel turning. You don't just show up self-flagellating, handing out money, if you have not done anything wrong, and if you truly believe
that... No,
that's
not true. What they did was wrong was they fired Joe Paterno.
Okay, but as the trial's going, they... let's get this out of the way, too.
Okay.
And I don't know. This is... framingpaterno.com is a must read, because it's not a crazy conspiracy thing. You're dealing with facts and figures. You've not convinced me, and that's not why I had you. I wanted to hear you.
Sure.
I do. You've convinced me that this was a shitstorm. I'm not sold. Jerry Sandusky, out of these 9 or 8 people, is not guilty of child molestation. What I do have been convinced by you in our private conversations is that there is no way, and I was of the other thinking completely 2 weeks ago.
Mm-hmm.
Of course Joe Paterno knew.
Mm-hmm.
And then housed a child molester in Jerry Sandusky.
Mm-hmm.
And you can explain to me why that's absolutely incorrect, and you have. Well,
I appreciate that. To me, you have to understand the full case, though, because that's only part of the injustice. And I hope we'll, since it deals with Paterno, can we talk about the McQueary thing? Because that...
Yeah, but Paterno, this is important to a listener. Paterno did he not ever cover up for Joe?
No, fuck no.
And you know that how?
I know that because
just timelines and facts.
That all goes to the McQueary episode.
Yeah, let's go.
So let's go talk about the McQueary episode.
Mike McQueary was the guy that the public knows. This is what we know because this is what we've been told, and this is why a guy's in jail. He walked in on Jerry Sandusky having sex with a kid, told Joe Paterno. Joe Paterno took it to his immediate superior. A lot of people think he should have went to the goddamn cops. And mm-hmm. he went, did the minimal legally right. that he could have and should have done, and he did.
Mm-hmm.
Mike McQueary is the guy where this thing just, they kicked the door down.
Yep.
Media-wise. This yep. where, for some reason, this ginger assistant, like, why this guy is the goddamn gatekeeper to Bedlam, I don't really... Well, I guess it's because of an eyewitness.
He's the only eyewitness, and it's an easily understood and horrific story. I mean, that is a story you can put in a headline or in a tweet. Assistant coach sees Sandusky raping a boy, tells Paterno, Paterno does nothing. Oh, my gosh! That is horrendous.
It doesn't fit. I just tried.
Oh, okay. It's well, like it's close. You can probably get that in 140 characters with some abbreviations.
Oh, that's it. Okay.
But the point is...
It is click.
It's a clear-cut narrative that the media bought in 2 days in November of 2011 with no facts. And let me prove to you, no facts.
You're going to, but quickly. If a guy comes... If that's the... How does that story get to the media?
Because it was leaked through the grand jury presentment.
In 2 days?
You know, on November... No, that was interesting. That's the interesting part. It took a couple of days for the media to catch on. It was leaked on November 4th or 5th-ish, the night of the 4th, morning of the 5th. It was clearly leaked for the purposes of having it get out into the media. The media didn't obsess about this till the 7th. You know why?
But it was leaked by a grand jury?
No, it was leaked by the government for the purposes of creating bad
okay,
publicity.
Okay, I was going to say, then this is the fastest... Thing that's
yeah, I don't
happened.
Know. The government put it on a website.
Because if I get wind of that, even if I don't believe it, that's not clickbait. That's I'm being told
The government clearly leaked it on purpose.
Government of Pennsylvania.
Yes. The Attorney General's office.
Attorney General prosecution.
Right.
That is the government.
And this will be an issue at Jerry Sandusky's next hearing on May 20th. But
same lawyer?
No, different lawyer. Al Lindsay's his name. Anyway, the point is that this gets leaked. And in this document, this is so, to me, you know, sometimes the simplest facts are the most important because people understand them. Mike McQuarrie originally claims that this horrendous episode happened on March of 2002. Joe Paterno died thinking that the episode that destroyed his legacy was March 2002. We later learned that wasn't right. It wasn't March, and it wasn't 2002. It was actually February of 2001. Now, why is this important? To me, it's incredibly important because
I'm going to say on your side, if you're football and you're Mike McQuarrie and you've played football, and I know just from following football, there's no mistaking a season and there's no mistaking a year.
Exactly.
Especially when you have a schedule on every locker. And as a fan, hey, Seahawks won the Super Bowl this year.
You do
no,
tend,
no, they didn't.
You think about everything in years. That's a great point.
It's a football, especially Penn State. It's
right.
Like, there's only 12.
And so what we're being asked to believe is that McQuarrie sees a local legend, Jerry Sandusky, raping a boy, and it's so little importance to him that he forgets the date, the month, and the year, and he thinks it happens after 9/11 when it actually happened before 9/11. Now, that to me is a clear cut. He's being asked about this 10 years after the fact, which is incredibly important, and the media just discarded that. But to me, this is a clear cut sign, Jay, that whatever happened was not that big of a deal. Because if it was, you wouldn't mess up the date that badly. And by the way, you know who gave them the right date? Jerry Sandusky. Jerry knew it couldn't be 2002. And the reason why he knew it couldn't be 2002 is because he remember Alan Myers, the boy who was there that night? He remembered that he had done that. He had gone into the showers with Alan in a Penn State locker room, in the Penn State locker room, when his book came out. He had remembered taking Alan to a book signing. Well, the book had come out in January of 2001. And so Jerry was like, this doesn't make any sense. How could it be 2002?
So Sandusky actually writes the timeline for the prosecution.
Which is, I think, really important, right? Because if you're guilty, if you're guilty, aren't you thrilled to have them get the wrong year? and you know, or you don't want to give them any information. So Jerry's like, no. This was 2001 when this happened. Well, it turns out once they found the email chain, he was right. It was absolutely February 1st of 2001. And so here's what really happens, all right? The narrative that the media bought into is horrendous. It's easily understood. And if it's remotely true, I understand everyone's outrage, and I understand why Paterno would get fired, all right? If anything close to that happened, I want to make that clear. I get it. Nothing close to that really happened. Here's what really happened. McQuarrie goes in to the showers on...
According to whom?
Israel. Mike McQuarrie.
Okay.
He comes into the showers, and he actually, you know, he hears sounds in the shower that he thinks are sexual. Hears. He's thinking, he actually says this, he implies it at least, he's expecting to see sex between a man and a woman. You know, probably some assistant coach banging a girlfriend or something. And so he's kind of like curious, like, oh, this will be interesting. See what's going on here. He turns the corner and for 2 or 3 seconds, this is his own testimony, looks through a mirror and sees, instead of a man and a woman, he sees Jerry Sandusky and a boy. Now, this would be shocking to anybody, especially if they were expecting sex between a man and a woman, right? I mean, expectation is everything in life. So
just the boy, period. Like, you don't need to put it in context.
Okay, it's weird. I'm fully
weird. Fucking so lead pipe to the head.
Oh, but hold on a second. This is it's important to remember. This is before the Catholic Church scandal has come known publicly. So the world is a little bit different place in 2001, especially
in
happy.
I think people are fucking. Oh. And I walk in on a guy, and I think he's fucking a child.
Well,
I'm taking a bat to his head.
Well, that doesn't happen.
I'll take my chance.
Exactly. But that doesn't happen. Not only does he not take a bat to Sandusky's head, he doesn't even make himself known. He doesn't even identify the boy. He leaves the boy there. By the way, how does that make any sense? You're going to leave the premises, leaving a boy with Jerry Sandusky that you now say 10 years later was being raped? Seriously? Mike McQuarrie is a 6'4", 220-pound guy in his mid-late 20s. I mean, he could kick the crap out of Jerry Sandusky.
How did they not see his bright orange hair in the mirror?
Right. Oh, it's impossible to miss him. I am convinced.
Where does he go from the showers?
He goes out and he calls his dad.
Okay.
And his dad says, come on over. And his dad brings over a guy by the name of Dr. Dranoff, who would technically, or at least thought he was, a mandated reporter for child sex abuse, although there's some question as to whether or not he really would have been a mandated reporter. That's illegal.
So the dad brings a guy over
right.
The dad thinks he's legit.
Well, no, he knows the dad. What I mean by mandated child sex reporter is that it's important to interpret his non-actions when he hears Mike's story. That's why that's significant.
But the father called him
yes.
because he thought that was the appropriate thing
sure,
to do.
Sure, sure. So they
but
come
Mr.
over.
Mr. McQuarrie is acting the way you or I would act. Like
you would think, but okay. Mr. McQuarrie is an important part
at
of the
point.
Story. Mr. McQuarrie is an important part of the story. So okay. the three of them get together, and this Dr. Dranoff, who again thinks he's a mandated reporter for child sex abuse, asks Mike three times, did you see a sex act? And according to Dr. Dranoff's testimony, three times Mike says, no, no. Okay, so what do they do?
My fourth question would have been, then why am I here?
Well, that's a good question. So what do they do? Mike McQuarrie's dad tells him, why don't you go see Joe Paterno? Now, that's a really odd thing to say, because if you saw rape, why aren't you going to the police? Now, I understand Joe Paterno's got a special place. He's Mike's boss. He's not Jerry's boss, that's important to point out. Jerry is retired at this point. Joe has no authority over Jerry Sandusky at this point. That's so incredibly important.
But Joe had authority in 1998 over Jerry Sandusky.
Well, we can talk about that.
No, excuse me. You know what? I apologize. 2008, Jerry Sandusky was not an employee of...
That's correct. No.
Was not.
No, he was not in 2001. He retired in 1999.
Did he have his football camp at Penn State University?
At what year?
2008 or 2009, 2010. Let's even
they were. It was not on the main campus. There may have been camps on satellite campuses. I'm not sure.
So my thing on my show was, Joe Paterno knows what football camps are happening at a football school. It's linebacker university.
Okay, well, can we have to get back to the origins of Joe Paterno's knowledge, okay? If
it's well,
okay.
That's what I'm saying. Right. I mean, I'm just like...
I understand. So I want to talk about what really happens next. So McQuarrie gets told by his dad, go see Joe Paterno. Now, why did that happen? I believe what happened... And this is important about the date. This is why the date is so important. When the story hit the fan, Jay, we didn't know that this happened in 2001. We thought it happened in 2002. We now know that 2 days before this episode, something really important happened. Really important. Kenny Jackson, who was a famous wide receiver at Penn State, who was the wide receivers coach at that time, leaves Penn State to go to the Pittsburgh Steelers. This leaves open a job. It leaves open the same job that Mike McQuarrie would eventually fill, but not this year, not the next year, not the next year. It would be 3 years later that Mike McQuarrie fills that job. 3 years. That's important for a couple of really significant reasons. Number one, it shows there's no cover-up, because if there was a cover-up... The first thing Joe Paterno would do when Mike McQuarrie comes to tell him about whatever he was that he saw.
Oh, he'd hire him.
He'd hire him because he's a graduate assistant at this point. You know what a graduate assistant is. Yeah. Graduate assistants are nobodies. So he would say, hey, Mike, you've been doing a great
job. Unless you're listening and you're a subscriber, then we're saying that, you know, with italics. We know you're big somebodies.
Right. So so the point here is.
And I didn't say it.
If Joe was trying to do a cover-up, he says, Mike, you've been doing a great job for us as a grad assistant. Guess what? Kenny Jackson just left. There's a job open. Congratulations. You're our new wide receivers coach. That didn't happen. It's also important because it's a motivation for Mike's dad to tell him to go see Joe. Because Mike's dad knows, it's been reported in the papers, that the Kenny Jackson job is open and that Mike would be a great candidate for it. So he tells Mike, go see Joe Paterno. And in my view, it's because this is a wonderful opportunity to get some FaceTime with Joe Paterno with a job opening. And you're going to be a good Boy Scout and tell him that you saw this thing happen. You want to make sure that every I is dotted and T is crossed about a guy everyone knows Joe doesn't like.
And Paterno sniffs bullshit a mile away, even in his aged state at that time. What he said to Mike McQueary, when McQueary said, I got to come talk to you about something.
Well, this is an interesting point. McQueary testifies that when he calls Joe, Joe says, if this is about a job, don't bother coming over. I don't got one for you.
Amazing.
I think that statement was never said. Sue Paterno, I was in the Paterno family kitchen, at the very same table where McQueary and Paterno had their infamous conversation. And there's a bunch of family members around and friends, and I happened to mention this testimony by McQueary. It wasn't even a big, in my mind at this point, it wasn't even a big deal. Sue Paterno's over getting ice cream out of the freezer. She turns around and screams at me, that never happened. Now, it's important to point out, she was there that day. And she was married to this guy for 50-some years. So what I think is happening is Mike is subconsciously creating testimony that contradicts his cover story.
Do we know what Mike told his dad?
Well, no, because Mike McQueary's dad now has dementia.
Binary answer. So it's no.
Well, Mike McQueary's dad couldn't testify because he's got dementia now.
And do we know what Mike told Joe Paterno?
Well, I think we do.
No, I mean, can we search and read it?
Yeah, we know what Joe Paterno's testimony is.
Which was?
Joe Paterno and his grand jury testimony makes it sound like what Mike might have told him 10 years earlier.
What do you mean might have?
Well, it's phrased very ambiguously. Joe uses the words sexual nature. He says, was it a sexual nature? Now, this is where things get tricky. Because at the time, the media says, well, fuck. Why would Joe Paterno be admitting that Mike McQueary told him that there was something of a sexual nature in 2001 unless it was true? But here's what you have to understand about Joe Paterno. Joe Paterno at this time is 84 years old. This is something that happened 10 years prior. Mike McQueary is a trusted assistant. He trusts Mike implicitly. Mike is his only conduit to the field at this point. Because Joe's basically...
But he doesn't like Mike.
No. He likes Mike McQueary. No, he didn't like Jerry Sandusky. Joe doesn't like Jerry Sandusky.
But Joe's also not filling this job, and Joe would be aware enough to give Mike the job if there was a cover-up, having the cognitive thought to think and fill in the dots to cover his own ass. So it's it's two separate...
This is getting complicated. Let me tell you
No, it's not. It's Joe having the smarts to hire Mike immediately if there was a cover-up.
Right, but he didn't do
that.
And
then Joe now, in this same time frame, not really all there.
Okay. No, because that's 10 years later. This is 10 years later.
And I apologize.
So here's what really happens. To take this, so to make it as simple as possible, because I know this conversation is getting long, but hopefully it's still very interesting.
It's fascinating.
Here's what really happens with Joe Paterno. Joe Paterno gets subpoenaed to testify about something he doesn't remember what the fuck Mike McQueary told him 10 years earlier. He's 84 years old.
I honestly, and I'm being serious, I would not know unless it was I saw that guy having anal sex with that person, even if it wasn't a kid. Right. If I saw John Ziegler and Paul Feinbaum, you did a great job on the show, having anal sex right there. I walked in on these two guys. That would never leave my mind.
Right.
Just Jerry Sandusky naked alone with anybody. I'm like, oh, no, I remember that.
Okay, but the reality is, you have to remember, Joe Paterno's a Republican. He's pro-prosecution. There's evidence from people who were there in the meeting with him that it was the prosecution who met with him just before his testimony who effectively planted the phrase sexual nature into his mindset. And so Joe is trying to be helpful here. Joe is trying to help he's trying to back up his assistant, Mike McQueary. He's trying to help the prosecution, and his son, Scott Paterno, who's his attorney, is convinced that this whole story is true, and so he wants to get out in front of it. They want to help. They want to be on the good side here. So because of two words, Joe Paterno gets hung on two words that I don't believe were accurate, that I don't believe were his real memory, that he wasn't sure about, and which are inconsistent with everything else that he did in this case and everything we know about the case, because we already know the kid that was there, the alleged victim, said nothing happened. So McQuarrie
couldn't... That's the most important... Hold on. Right. That's the most important indelible mark.
Exactly.
On this entire
that's the whole case.
Is that the kid...
Right.
And Joe Paterno is sexual in nature, and McQuarrie and all these characters that you
the
brought in.
The kid is everything.
All... But that's what I'm saying is what I said to you 2 hours ago. All these names that get put in. You're so vested in this. The fact that the kid... that Mike McQuarrie may or may not have seen with Jerry Sandusky in the shower. That's what we know as a society. America knows Jerry Sandusky right. fucked the kid in the shower, right. and Paterno knew, and he fucking covered it up.
Right. Well,
that kid has said over and over
nothing.
That did not happen.
In fact, he's written letters to the editor in the newspaper in his name, Alan Myers, saying that Jerry's the greatest thing that ever happened.
That's the signal right. in the noise. And I think right. that is it. Like like him getting the fucking date wrong. Like, no, the kid in the whole thing.
I agree.
Said, this is incorrect.
But let me tell you why McQuarrie was so easily manipulated. Because this is something that's not been widely publicized, but I have proof
These
of it.
These are a lot of manipulated grown-ups.
Well, hold on a second. Let me tell you the story.
Has a moment gone by since I've first had contact with you? I have not listened to a word you said.
You've been very open-minded, and
so
I appreciate
like,
that. So here's why Mike McQuarrie was so vulnerable. So Mike McQuarrie gets a phone call 10 years after this happens to his wife. His wife calls him. Ironically, he's in the same building where this episode occurs and says, investigators want to talk to you. Mike McQuarrie then calls friends in a panic. Not because he's terrified that, oh my God, they're finally going to talk to me about Jerry Sandusky 10 years later. No. And we know this because Don Vanatta from ESPN, I have a recording of him bragging that he was going to report this, and then ESPN censored it. It's on YouTube. You can find it yourself. You should listen to it, Jay. It's amazing.
What's the man's name?
Don Vanatta is the ESPN reporter's name. Van Natta.
Okay.
Anyway, the point here is...
I repeat, because she writes it down.
No, I got it.
Put it on my website.
So the panic is not because, oh my God, they're talking to me about Sandusky. The panic is, this is Mike McQuarrie, who in April of that year had been sending dick pics of himself through a Penn State phone to a woman, not his wife. And he thought that's what they were coming after him for. So he's shitting his fucking pants.
This is record.
I have Don Vanatta of ESPN on tape bragging to me that he has this bit by bit proven phone records, the whole bit, the photos, everything that he's going to report about it in ESPN, the magazine. And then I have him in a different interview from another reporter trying to explain why it didn't get in the magazine. And it's hilarious. It's all on YouTube. So, and by the way, I had known about this before Don Vanatta told me. I had known about this from the very, 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 very highest sources of this story. The very highest. Okay? So this is, this story is, I've gotten, it's nailed from both directions. So the point is, he's shitting his pants. And when investigators come to him and it's not about this, and instead they're telling him, Mike, we've been investigating Jerry Sandusky for 2 years. We think he's a child molester. We've got this kid, Aaron Fisher, who says he was molested for 2 years. We hear you saw something. Can you help us? We desperately need a witness. We think we've got a really bad guy here. We got to put him away. You're Mike McQuarrie. You're like, shit, man. What do you need?
Do they really lead like that? Isn't like an invest? Don't you sit and you go, hey, how you doing? Good. You work with so-and-so? Yeah. You work with this guy? Yeah. You worked with, yeah. You know Curtis Enos, the running back? Oh, yeah. I know him really well. He's a bear. Oh, yeah. Jerry Sandusky, you worked with him? Like, you mix it in? Do you have a good relationship with Mr. Like, it's as if, like, these investigators went to these people in each separate situation of... We have so much shit on Jerry Sandusky. There's a monster in this town.
Right.
And we just need an eyelash more.
Because we need some help.
There's a monster that's raping children in this town.
You're going to help.
That's how they went at
it. You're going to help it. You're going to help. Absolutely.
But did they really, I'm asking.
Oh, no. Every evidence in this case is, that tape recording of victim four, is this the MO? They said, yeah, sure, we do this all the time. And by the way, it's funny you said something about, the relationship that McQuarrie had during this time, the 10 years between the episode and when he talks about it publicly, Jerry Sandusky, and I know no one wants to believe anything Jerry says because he's the most hated man in the world, but just hear me out on this. Jerry's an interesting witness on this because Jerry didn't know Mike was the witness. And why is that important? Jerry spends the next 10 years interacting with Mike McQuarrie, having no idea that Mike's the guy who saw him in the shower with Alan Myers. So he's able to look at their relationship with a with no jaundice. And interestingly, Jay, Mike McQuarrie plays in not one but two Jerry Sandusky charity golf tournaments after this event happens.
Alan now, Myers is the kid's name?
No, Mike McQuarrie.
No, the kid in the shower.
Alan Myers, yes.
Alan Myers has testified nothing happened.
He gave a statement nothing happened. He never testified at trial at all.
Because to bring him to trial would be the end of the
trial. Exactly. The prosecution didn't want him there.
All of this is window dressing compared to Alan Myers.
I understand. Alan Myers is the whole case. But I'm just bolstering everything because no one wants to believe anything I say. But it's important to point out. So McQuarrie plays in these golf tournaments. But not only does he play in golf tournaments that are sponsored by Jerry Sandusky after this event, he jokes around with him physically at an Easter Seals charity football game where they're playing on the opposite teams. So, I mean, people have witnessed, they're witnessing McQuarrie and Sandusky, like, you know, arm around the neck and that kind of stuff. This is a guy who he allegedly saw raping? No. Here's the proof that McQuarrie didn't see a rape. This is the ultimate proof, and it's in McQuarrie's own testimony.
Well, no, Alan Myers is the proof.
Well, but even McQuarrie's own testimony proves it. In the preliminary hearing of December of 2011, McQuarrie says, I was telling people around the program that Jerry shouldn't be around the lockers. Now that sounds like something consistent with someone who saw somebody doing something really bad, right? That I'll admit, wow, that's good evidence, Mike. So on cross-examination, he's asked, so when did you start to tell people that Jerry shouldn't be around the program? Was it before or after investigators came to you and told you that there was an investigation of Jerry Sandusky for child sex abuse? And Mike says, oh, it was after. Bingo. That's the whole case.
No, bingo is Alan Myers.
I get that, but
why do you get frustrated when I say things that help you?
Well, I appreciate it.
Like, I'm literally telling...
But this is out of Mike McQuarrie's own mouth.
Yeah, but I'm telling a million people that the person that we all know... Mike McQuarrie walked into a shower, saw Jerry Sandusky having sex with a kid, and then he told Joe Paterno. Joe Paterno covered for it, and he died that way. The kid said it didn't happen to the point where during this steamroll of events, it went, except for you, don't come to court. That'll fuck everything up. The prosecution doesn't let Alan Myers in. That's the signal there.
I agree with you, but I'm just bolstering
like
every
element of
this.
2 years between jobs and like Joe, and then she said this over there. Like, do you think you're so involved in this that you may have crossed the line into not being the best voice for it?
Well, people can just, well, first of all, I'm the one that knows more about the case than anybody.
I know that. There's been about six times in this podcast where I've said something to affirm what you've just said, and you've come back at me like we were arguing.
Well, I have never claimed to be perfect.
Alan Myers is the, and you're like, no.
Like, you make a very good point, Jay.
And to you, it's about McQuarrie, who, because it's personal, like this guy that you've discovered these things that have happened, it's vile. These things
you make a very good point, Jay. Jay, you make an outstanding point.
Like, I'm saying, yes, this kid, this is crazy.
I agree with you. I just want everyone to know the full context of everything because there's so much evidence on my side. And so, and just to finish the
point. Did Joe Paterno cover for Jerry Sandusky?
Fuck no.
How do you know that?
There's no evidence that he did. There's no logic that he did. There's no motivation for him to do so.
And there's no evidence that he did. That's the sentence.
There's no evidence. None. Zero.
Is there evidence that he did not?
Well, it's hard to prove a negative, but
like when
atheists come at me, prove
your sky daddy.
But here's the proof. If he was going to do it, he would have given Mike McQuarrie that Kenny Jackson job, Jay.
No.
You don't buy that? That's the first thing that would have happened in a cover-up.
You are yelling.
I'm sorry.
That's what I'm saying.
It's getting a little late.
I'm saying Joe Paterno, everyone, Jerry Sandusky raped a kid in the shower. The kid that got raped in the shower said, no, I was not. So Mike McQuarrie told Joe Paterno something. His dad is no longer in the picture because he has dementia and he can't have a cognitive conversation with people that will ask him things like this. Joe Paterno has since died, and Joe Paterno said that Mike McQuarrie came to him and said, yeah, the way Joe talks. By the way, his whole life, Joe Paterno, everything is, but sexual in nature, that's what he testified to. That's what Joe Pa is the most, and we're talking about.
I understand.
In your own words, the most revered, respected man.
Right.
This is Joe Pa.
Right.
They don't make statues for guys that you, right. that.
By the way, that's why they arrested Jerry Sandusky. If Joe Paterno had not said that, they wouldn't have gone with the case. And I mean that sincerely. Joe Paterno's testimony, if it had gone the other direction, if he had unequivocally said, Mike never told me anything about that, they would never have arrested Jerry Sandusky because they would have known there was no chance of getting a conviction.
The answer to the question of whether or not he covered it all or whether he was culpable is the amount of time that this conversation happened and that trial. Because if Joe Paterno is going to testify, he's a Christian, he's a Republican, like he could be all prosecution all he wants. Mm. But at the end of the day, that is a diehard Italian Catholic. Hand on the Bible, hand in the air.
Right.
He's not going to go against Christ to appease pro-law.
Mm. Okay.
So if he was told that a sexual thing happened.
He wasn't. He
testified to
it. No, but he got. Have you ever heard of someone misrefreshing someone's recollection? At 84 years old, he's trusting my. I've spoken to Jay Paterno, who was the assistant coach and Joe Paterno's son, about this very thing. I said, why didn't you guys rain hellfire down on Mike McQueary? And Jay says to me, he says, Joe told us he's suffered enough. Let him alone. Joe was a very loyal guy. He was especially loyal to his coaches and to his players. And I think it's really important. Go search photos of Mike McQueary and Joe Paterno in the later years of Joe Paterno's career. Mike is his conduit to the field. Jay was basically being pushed out as the head coach at Penn State. He had very little impact on what was happening on the field. His only way to get a message onto the field was through Mike. So Mike's his lifeline. So if Mike's telling him, yeah, coach, don't you remember I told you it was a sexual thing? If Joe doesn't remember that, he's going to go, holy shit, am I getting that old? I don't remember that. Mike's my guy. Mike wouldn't be lying to me. This must be true. And so at 84 years old, he testifies to something he wasn't sure about.
This is so enormous what we're talking about.
I know.
That we've been going 2.5 hours.
And I appreciate it.
We're going to take the catcher out here in a second, and he will drop the ball, and we're going to be safe. The magnitude of what happened at Happy Valley with the insurance. We didn't even talk about the insurance and the people coming forward.
I can explain that in 30 seconds. If you
I don't believe that to be true.
Okay.
And it deserves a lot more than 30 seconds, okay. In all fairness. The magnitude of this and the amount of people that came forward and the amount of money that went out and the fact that they went back to court and unsealed documents and they're fucking hemming and hawing over who pays what. This, I'll tell you, you have not convinced me. And by the way, it was never discussed that I'm going to come over and I'm going to convince you. You said you were going to come over here and tell me the truth, and I don't know a lot of these facts, and you were correct. I'm not convinced that Jerry, I'm still that juror going, I don't know about Sandusky.
That's fine.
The Paterno thing, this is what I do know. If anybody goes to framingpaterno.com, there are so many, this isn't like Abraham Lincoln had a secretary called Kennedy. Isn't that weird? Yeah, it'd be weird if a guy wasn't going to fucking rot in jail from the gills and then a guy died in shame and they took a goddamn statue down. It's horrible fascinating. Not fascinating like, oh, wow.
This is not a conspiracy theory. It's not.
No. It's, and I've said that earlier. You have so much data. I think you're going to have to step back at some point. And like, because the stuff that you've shown me, the record, like you have 3 hours of Jerry Sandusky speaking.
Mm-hmm.
That alone, you could just take to Sundance and just to have like photos over it.
In a rational world, yes, but we're not living in a rational world.
Mm.
No one wants to hear this side of the story right now.
Who the fuck doesn't want to hear Jerry Sandusky talking?
Because everyone thinks he's the most horrible human being on the planet.
Did he testify for himself?
He did not, no.
Well, that's it. There it is.
To me, he did. That's about it.
Huh?
I'm the closest he came to testifying. Right?
You are so into the woods on this, you can't see that America would line up to listen to those tapes. No. I'm not suggesting. I'm informing you.
Okay.
Now, this is me giving you the truth.
I'm hearing.
There is not a fucking person alive that wouldn't go, give me those headphones. Get the fuck out of here. Give me that shit. If you, what is on those 3 hours of tape? It's like, well, this fucking Nixon, the 14, 16 minutes, we're all like, what could that have been? Well, the shit he left in. You know what I mean?
I hear you.
And I don't know why you feel that way. And it's
because I've been beaten to a pulp.
But what you
for the last
have
4 years
is you. If you let that tape, if you get some type of platform, and I don't want to hear about the fucking media and all this, because you can.
On the Today Show.
You could have a podcast. Literally, you could have a podcast. Go over to Podcast One. Go to Adam Carolla and go, I want to play the Jerry Sandusky tapes 20 minutes at a time. Every Tuesday.
Can you set that up for me, Jay?
I'd be happy to set it up. Send the fucking tweet to Adam.
Adam's not going to answer me. He would you, but...
What? But listen, what you're saying, he won't, they won't, they won't. You've discovered all this stuff, and the only thing you haven't discovered is the fact, all you have to do is go, here, it's here.
Yeah.
That's a truth.
I
And before anybody fucking tweets me about him being nuts, or tweets John Ziegler about me being a fucking nut, look... I want to know as much as I can about every conceivable topic.
And I appreciate that.
I don't think Jerry Sandusky was proven innocent. I think his lawyer, if what I'm being told is being told, and I know the letter of the law per victim all at the same time, but the ramifications financially and all the things that you have at framingpaterno.com, your documentary, it makes you step back for a second and go, Jesus Christ. They're like, this is all so far. Like, why was everybody so bananas? Why were they outside Joe Paterno's house so quickly? It's, you got a mountain of stuff. I think half of that, three quarters of that mountain you don't need, because what you do have is so goddamn fucking alarming and shocking.
Well, I appreciate that. The reason why I have piled on, for lack of a better phrase, is because the burden of proof in this case is so enormous, right? Because of the fact that the emotions are so high, and because of the fact that
you're getting pulled in when you go like, and he's a fucking quack, and our so-called prize, and it's like, bro, you have 3 hours one time,
right?
Like, you essentially have, if you, John Ziegler, Siegmund Freud on Twitter, you have essentially, if Jerry Sandusky took the stand in his defense on tape. Is that correct?
Basically, yeah.
What the fuck are you talking about?
And so he was actually taking, you know, it's interesting. Most of it has to do with taking, is Jerry Sandusky defending Joe Paterno? Because that was my focus at the time, was that I knew that Paterno could not have been guilty of this.
You don't think people want to hear that? You can resurrect the dead.
Well, can I just really very quickly just address the most recent news? Because I honestly can't explain the settlement stories, these bogus 1970s stories. Here's what happened, Jay, very quickly. When Penn State gave away the money, there were basically three criteria that you had to meet. You had to be within the statute of limitations, which is the age of 30 in Pennsylvania. You had to be a member of Jerry Sandusky's charity, The Second Mile, and you had to have a connection to Penn State. If you had those three, no matter what you told them, you got money. The reason why the guys from 1971 and 1976 are making these allegations that they told Joe Paterno, it's not because they actually told Joe Paterno. It's because those guys have a problem. The charity didn't exist until 1977, so they have no connection to the charity. And they're way past the statute of limitations, because obviously if you're a teenager in the 70s, you're way past 30 now in 2016. So because they struck out on those first two, they had to hit a grand slam on the third one. And there's the only way to hit a grand slam on the third one, your connection to Penn State, is you told Joe Paterno. It's a lie. It's an obvious lie, but it's a lie to get money, where they were obviously guided by trial lawyers who knew the lay of the land. And I'm not talking out of my ass on this. I have intimate knowledge of the settlement process that I will eventually reveal that is a bombshell nature.
And you've been very transparent with the things that you have on framingpaterno.com. This stuff with these recordings of Sandusky, it's like you kind of have the Ark of the Covenant in your hands here.
I wish people looked at it that way.
No, I'm speaking for the aggregate.
Well,
I
appreciate that, Jay.
There's no one alive that does not want to hear this conversation.
Okay.
No matter what, I think you've been told what you're telling me right now is essentially what you're explaining.
Have post-traumatic stress disorder from this entire case. I'll agree with that.
Corey, 3 hours of Jerry Sandusky defending Joe Paterno. Are you in?
Yeah.
That's a mom of two girls. Like, she's not even in the football world. Like, yeah.
I hear you.
But I think your reaction is through conditioning. Not, I think 4 years.
I have been fucked over for 4.5 years.
I understand. I think for, and somebody listening, not as much as the fucking victims. No. Geez. Don't say anything.
I'm
just going to stand with the victims until I'm proven otherwise.
I understand that.
Because God fucking forbid. You know what I mean?
I'm with you on that, Jay. I got a 4-year-old daughter. I get it.
Relax, buddy. What I'm saying is that the stuff you have with Sandusky, you're holding. It's it. That's the thing.
Well, if there's anybody out there that can help me tell this story in a way that we can change the world, I'm all in. So please contact
podcast.
Me.
I mean, you have a job. Your radio show with Leah. I mean, if you could do a pot every two. You know what? After you download the free More Stories app on your phone, get this app where every Monday you're going to get 20 minutes of Jerry Sandusky from jail explaining how Joe Paterno is not culpable for covering up molestation. Like, this. Like, I want to grab you and shake you.
Again, you're sounding like my wife.
I'll tell you this. You have not convinced me about Sandusky, and I'm not sure about Paterno. But hold on.
Not even Paterno? I thought I at least convinced John Paterno. But
I don't know. I mean, he testified to a thing. I got to go with, and if we're going with what's written only, as I said earlier, I got to go by what's the
court. But if he was part of a cover-up, then why did he testify that
when
way?
You say words like cover-up, you have a kid saying I wasn't molested. You got 3 hours of tape of Jerry. How much total, Sandusky?
3.5, I guess.
You have 3.5 hours of Jerry Sandusky.
Somewhere in that range.
Maybe. Those are your two pillars that won't go away. Are you talking about the two pillars that went away, that went down? It's Paterno and McQuarrie?
The McQuarrie and Aaron Fisher were the two pillars of this case that collapsed.
Well, you have two pillars that are uncollapsible, and that's the kid in the shower that started the whole...
I thought so, too. But, Jay, just to reiterate, I waived the statement on the Today Show in the prime slot. The prime slot, 7:35 slot.
I'm a myth. Really? Are you new? Really? You think in an 8-minute morning program, Matt Lauer is going to take it and go, all right, we're going live the rest of the day.
It's not a fucking presidential assassination.
No. You're holding a piece of paper
for all
you know.
The point is, not one member of the media contacted me and said,
the media. This is a media. I am the media right now.
You don't like me talking about the media, but the media agenda on this case is unprecedented.
You are the media right now.
I'm fighting against a group of people.
You're not. Right now, we're talking about it. Right. We are on an island.
Right.
This is the media. This is the new media. No commercials.
And I appreciate
it. 3 hours.
And I understand that. But Jay, just to be clear, the mainstream news media, which still has some power in this country, has a stranglehold on this narrative. They look at this story like 5-year-olds look at Santa Claus. Try convincing a 5-year-old that Santa Claus doesn't exist.
If you release it onto the iTunes on an internet podcast, it lives forever. Mm-hmm. It never goes away. Mm-hmm. That's all I'm gonna say.
No
media can stop that. No one.
Well, you still need a way to be able to publicize it, and
you have over 100,000 Twitter followers. Here,
no,
click the link.
You have 14,000 Twitter followers.
No, I added a comma. Look, I'm not going to fucking talk to you anyway.
I appreciate what you're saying, and I'm open to any and all suggestions let me leave you with this, because people think, what's his motivation, right? Is he getting paid? Fuck no.
I'm
destroying my career over this. Not getting paid. It's costing me money. I'm facing charges that are completely bogus in an episode that's going to cost me money to defend. And so I'm not doing this. Here's my point. If tonight, Jay Mohr, if you had the power to say, all right, Ziegler, this all gets fixed. Justice is done. Everyone that deserves to be exonerated is exonerated. But you, Ziegler, you get zero credit, and it does nothing for you, your life, or your career.
I know you would.
I would take it
I know
in
it
a
already.
Fucking heartbeat.
And I think the listeners know that, too.
In a fucking heartbeat. So That's all I want. I just want this thing to be fixed. This was such a huge injustice.
Hashtag release the tapes.
Fair enough.
Hashtag release the tapes.
Well, most of them are already released. There's an hour on YouTube.
No, there isn't. That's coming out. Fuck that. You have 3.5 hours of you speaking with Jerry Sandusky that nobody's ever heard. You have the power. The media has no control over you. This is the media right now. Hold on. I'm not. This is not subjective. I'm informing you of that.
I appreciate it, Jay.
It's Corolla calls it the pirate ship, and this guy, you can go on Joe Rogan. You can go on any. There's you can pick your spots. It's the new media. And if it's the truth, and it's the recording is a truth. It's a fucking conversation between two guys. There's no misinterpreting the fact that this is the conversation because you just let it out there. I'm going to tell you this. I appreciate you coming in, and I appreciate framingpaterno.com. It's a tough hustle, my man, and I see the toll it takes on you. When people are agreeing with you, you're covering up. And you're brave. You're braver than I am.
Well, I want to express my appreciation for you having me, being open-minded. It's very rare in this day and age, especially for a celebrity, to have an open mind and the courage to say, hey, wait a minute, maybe I could be possibly wrong about this. Let me find out more from somebody who actually knows.
I was wrong about it. How about this? I was wrong about a lot.
Yeah, well, it wasn't your fault. It's because of the news media coverage you absorbed. And so I want to thank you for your time. It's been very interesting spending this time with you. This has been by far the most in-depth and most interesting interview I've done out of hundreds on this case.
And we haven't even, it's like we're at 8% going up. Like, it's not even the surface.
And I'm glad that this will be a historical record until, well, after I'm dead. So thank you very
much. You're going to go way before I am, dude. I'm going to be like 111, cryogenics. I'll be with Ted Williams' head something. Me, Walt Disney, and Ted Williams are going to be a three-headed guy like Rosie Greer in that fucking movie.
Well, hearing your
hashtag release the tapes.
Hearing your hearing your Norm Macdonald impression in person was worth the trip.
I can't do it.
Nothing else.
I don't want him to ever think I'm mocking him because I love him so much.
Well, it was worth the trip, and thank you for being open minded. I really appreciate it. Framingpaterno.com.
Christopher Walken would tell you, yeah, release the tapes. It's the right thing to do. Let him hear it. No, we're not making light of this. In fact, it's the opposite. It's heavier than you think. More Stories Podcast, free app. Use the Amazon banner. Zygmunt Freud is John Ziegler's Twitter. Hashtag release the tapes. Let's hear him. My friends, put your name on it. This is big stuff.
Say you want a rebel.